Welcome to Atlanta. It's Georgia versus LSU for the championship of the SEC.
Got a man out there and got him. Touchdown. Touchdown LSU.
This is the SEC championship game on CBS. Presented by Dr. Pepper.
Jason Aldean sets the scene for us as he's done every Saturday this fall. The SEC Championship on CBS, presented by Dr. Pepper, brings us Mercedes-Benz Stadium in Atlanta for a classic. The Tigers of LSU ranked number 2. The Georgia Bulldogs, only about an hour away from home in Athens, ranked number 4. Not only an SEC championship on the line here today, but it can be so much more. As you take a look at the college football playoff picture, LSU in the number 2 spot, Georgia at number 4. Oklahoma has stated their case already this afternoon with an overtime win. And with that, we bring you to Atlanta. Welcome, everybody. I'm Brad Nussler. My partner's Gary Danielson. We looked at the college football playoff picture. Oklahoma made their case.
Yes. So what transpired? You know what this means? The SEC has center stage right now, and these two teams are used to it.
Well, you and I have done a lot of games together. I don't know if we've ever had a classic matchup of strength versus strength. We've got the number 2 scoring team in the country, the number 2 defense in the country in Georgia. And for LSU, it all starts with their quarterback. It's been a remarkable journey for Joe Burrow. First last year after transferring from Ohio State, he won over his teammates. He's won the hearts of all the fans. At that point, he said, I didn't even know that it meant that much to the state of Louisiana. He even altered his jersey a little bit there. On senior day, and that's been the kind of year it has been for him. You know, about a half century ago, one of our favorite players made a name for himself and it became Broadway Joe. This is Bayou Joe, Gary, and it's almost rock star status right now.
I think so, but you don't get to be a rock star, whether it's Broadway or just Joe Burrow, without doing it on the field. Now, first, his stats are amazing, but he's been more than just a stats guy. He's been a guy on the field that has delivered leadership, toughness. He's turned this program around. But in this game, in this season, he's done it more than just by himself. He's had a partner, Clyde Edwards-Helaire, has given him that other guy like Batman needed Robin. Clyde Edwards-Helaire has come through for this LSU football offense.
You know, everybody's talked about the Georgia defense all year. You and I have even altered our boards a little bit because it's not like they've got a couple of stars. They've got about 20 guys that can play on that side.
They do. All year, I've been saying this is a Georgia no-name defense, but the more you watch, the more you find guys that stand out, Tyler Clark, they're all really veteran players at defensive tackle, just makes plays. And the two safeties, Richard LeCount, number 2, and J.R. Reed, number 20, those two guys, the veterans, have been in big games before. They'll direct this defense.
Ever since we knew what this matchup was, I've told everybody, let's say you can hold LSU to half their point total. Well, that'd be nice, but Georgia's still got to find some points of their own.
If they do hold this LSU offense down, the offense for Georgia has to come through, and I think they have to do it the way Kirby designed this team. Their offensive line, they're massive. He wants to win the line of scrimmage, and he's built and recruited massive offensive linemen. I think they'll attack the edges, but they're not going to do it without their quarterback. He loves this building. These stats here is when he feels most comfortable.
Jake Fromm has been a star in the big stage ever since Pee-wee ball and Warner Robins. Can he do it again today against the Tigers of LSU? Sellout crowd inside Mercedes-Benz Stadium. Here comes the fourth-ranked team in the country, the 11-1 Georgia Bulldogs, the champions of the East, making their 8th appearance in the SEC title game. And from Baton Rouge, the second-ranked Tigers undefeated at 12-0, making their sixth appearance and the first time in this game in 8 years. Jamie Erdahl on the field with Kirby Smart. Jamie.
Coach, without Lawrence Cager for the game, George Pickens in the first half, and a banged up DeAndre Swift, who do you turn to offensively to produce?
Well, we turn to DeAndre Swift. We turn to James Cook, Jake Fromm, the guys that got us here. We got good players here. We're fired up. Let them go play.
You're a born and bred defensive guy. What's the trick to slowing down LSU's offense?
You got to get your hands on them. You got to get your hands on them, get some incompletions.
Thanks, Coach.
Thanks.
Coach said earlier this week he was kind of looking forward to the challenge of going against LSU's offense until he started to watch the film.
And how about that? How this game is called may be important because he wants his DBs to get his hands on those receivers.
Jamie Erdahl has sprinted 53 yards to Ed Ogeron.
Coach, Tiger Nation believes you put together a team of destiny. This group seems special to you. What did you just say to them?
You know, just go out and play an LSU standard performance. Let's go play our game. It'll be a tremendous opportunity for our football team. This is a great team. It'll be a great challenge.
When I say this is Joe Burrow's final SEC game, what goes through your mind?
You know, I wish I had him for another year. But, you know, I think he's the Heisman winner. I hope he wins it. I think he's the best player in the country. But, you know, he's worried about winning and winning this game tonight.
Thank you, Coach.
Go Tigers.
Of course, you knew that was going to be the final two words. Coin flip going on at midfield. We'll find out who gets the ball first, and then we'll crown an SEC champion in the next 4 hours right here on CBS. The SEC Championship on CBS presented.
You'll never forget what you do today.
This is your moment. Be aware that in 60 minutes, you could be a champion.
There's 14 teams in this league that have the dream of making it to Atlanta.
When it rains, it pours. There will be blood in the water.
Being an LSU football player means everything to me.
Being a Georgia Bulldog is something special.
It means the world, just representing Louisiana.
It's incredible. It's everything you dream about. It's about playing for your home state.
Just a chance to represent the purple and gold.
I've dreamed about these days all my life.
The players should prepare to really push themselves to the limit.
And do whatever it takes to come home with the dub, because we are Georgia.
I know my boys will be ready.
This is it.
We've worked so hard as a team to get where we are.
This was the goal all along.
For us, it's just, you know, be who we are.
Understand that this is an environment where I have to play my best ball.
Grab a chase, touchdown, Tigers!
Edwards Elaire with a spin, and he'll have one. Touchdown, LSU.
They had to go through Alabama.
Biggest win for Ed Ogeron.
Go Dawgs.
Fromm going to throw it to the corner of the end zone.
Touchdown, Lawrence Cager spinning in the air.
DeAndre Swift to the house.
Trayvon Walker back in for a big loss.
Been watching these games ever since I was a kid.
It wouldn't mean the world to know that I put LSU in the history books.
It would be very special to this state, to this university. And you can always come back and say, hey, I helped put that number on the wall.
Who is going to put that number on the wall, as Jake Fromm put it? LSU and Georgia. Tigers won the toss and deferred. The series history, 28th SEC championship game. LSU leads the all-time series. East against West. Two top four teams, but only one championship trophy. From Atlanta, let's play ball. And Georgia will work from the 25-yard line. As we take a look at the Dr. Pepper starting lineups. And it all starts with a guy we've been talking about all week and for the last 2 hours on the pregame show, number 11, making his 41st straight start. That leads all of college football. Jake Fromm. And Jake's had some great moments in this building. Necessarily not wins all the time, but statistically, he's been big in this Mercedes-Benz Stadium over the last three trips. And he'll set his team up at the 25-yard line. And Brian Herrien opens up in the Georgia backfield. So all the talk about DeAndre Swift, I'm sure he'll be in there, but he's not going to take the first snap. And it's Fromm to throw, and he's going to go deep. Airs it out. Manziel, and it's in and out of the hands of Tyler Simmons. Should have had it.
That's what's been missing for Georgia, a lack of explosive plays. A couple weeks ago, we saw Fromm miss a couple throws, and this time he makes the throw, and it's dropped.
So they come out with the big play on the opening snap. And it should have been, could have been, wasn't. Second and 10. Charlie Warner, the tight end in the slot on top. They're going to throw it out in the flat to DeAndre Swift. Got a block from him. He only got about 3 yards out of it. It'll bring up third down. Here's the rest of the Georgia offense. Brian Herrien got the start, but it only took one snap for DeAndre Swift to come in there. We saw Georgia be excellent on third down against Florida, Gary, and we've seen them have some trouble, and now they don't have Lawrence Cager with an ankle injury and George Pickens for the first half after the fighting penalty against Georgia Tech. So he's missing two of his favorite weapons.
And for sure, Cager is a third down guy that Fromm loved to look for on these third and make a first down plays.
Third and 7. Fromm, pocket's going to collapse. He might have gotten face mask, but he goes down. Now, I think there's going to be a face mask on Damone Clark, and that would give Georgia a first down.
Dave Aranda, very aggressive here. 7-man at the line of scrimmage, and you can see reach out by Clark and inadvertently make the face mask, and Georgia will convert on the penalty. Big
first
play.
Foul. Face mask. Defense, 20-35. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
Considering the fact that they had the potential explosive plays, and remember, we talked to Kirby yesterday. He said we want to avoid third and long. They pick up the first third down conversion with a penalty.
LSU defensively. They got the big guys up front on that front three. Anchored by Tyler Shelvin, all 350 pounds of it. And in the back end, Grant Delpit, pretty much 100%. He's one of the best players in the conference when healthy. Herrien, maybe a yard, and it's Delpit who made the tackle.
We've been talking about DeAndre Swift being healthy, but the other number 7 in this game, Grant Delpit, is finally healthy again. He had that ankle that he really struggled with the second half of the season. He's 100% for this game, and he's a difference maker. I think one of Brad's favorite players.
He is. One of the best players in the country, not just the SEC.
Hard not to like that guy.
Yeah. Said he grew up wanting to be Ed Reed. I said, you're close.
Yep. Got pump and run coverage, free safety in the middle.
Second down and 9. Zamir White in the Georgia backfield. Fromm going to go deep down the sideline, and that one is caught by Landers.
They waved it out of bounds. Stingley was on coverage. Let's see if this deserves a replay, because it was caught. Stingley pushes him wide. Another perfect throw. Now, left foot came down first, I believe, and out of bounds. That's part of the coverage. But look who's starting off hot in this game, and we've talked about it in this building. Jake Fromm's on target. Absolutely.
On target, but two incompletions. That would have been big plays.
I'd take that. That's like in baseball, hitting the ball hard, and if somebody catches it, I'd say sooner or later it's going to find a spot.
Simmons will go in motion on another third down and long. Third and 9 from the 44. Fromm, deep middle this time. That one is caught, I believe, by Robertson. He thinks so. Let's see if the officials, they're going to say no.
Coming off the slot, Robinson's got his hands on it, and it looked like the ball hit the ground, and then he bobbled it. How about that?
And it went right through his hands. He did a pretty good acting job, but not good enough.
That one was not a great throw by Jake Fromm. He had him 10 yards open. He underthrew it.
I was going to say that one, he's actually open.
Yes,
he kind of he was covered.
He pulled the string on that one. He had him wide open. It happens a lot. It's like an open jump shooter in basketball. Sometimes you'd rather be covered.
Jake Kamada, especially in the second half of the season, had an excellent couple of months as a Georgia punter. Would like to keep it out of Stingley's hands. Stingley's just going to let this one go out of bounds, and that wasn't a great kick. And let's see where they spot it. Going to come out past the 25, I think, right around the 26-yard line. So that's where LSU will go to work on offense. And boy, the offense of Georgia had some opportunities. Simmons with a drop. Robertson couldn't get to that one. Big plays that they missed on early. No score in the first couple of minutes of the game from Atlanta. As we take a look at our Dr. Pepper starting lineups, and it starts with number 9, Joe Burrow. Sensational numbers. Over 4,300 yards through the air, 44 touchdowns, as he has equaled or surpassed all SEC passing records. And he is the heart and soul of this offense that is averaging almost 49 points a game. And here's the rest of the group that joins him. And Ja'Marr Chase might be on his way to the Biletnikoff Award as the nation's most outstanding receiver. He's got over 1,400 yards through the air and 17 touchdown catches, a school record.
As impressive as those wide receivers are, I still believe Georgia can't let LSU have a five-man attack. If they don't slow down Thaddeus Moss, their tight end, number 81, and Clyde Edwards-Helaire, number 22, they'll be in for a long day.
Georgia's first offensive snap, they threw deep. Let's see what LSU will do on their first snap of the ball game. They'll keep it on the ground to Edwards-Helaire. He got to the edge immediately, and he got maybe a first down. Run out by Richard LeCount. But that's what he's done all year, number 22.
And Ja'Marr Chase does more than just catch balls. He got a good block on the edge that time and allowed Clyde to get outside.
Picked up 9 defensively for Georgia. We'll see the lineup scroll across the bottom. Monty Rice, the leading tackler for the Dogs. Second down and a yard, empty backfield. With Burrow set to throw. Does completes it to Edwards-Helaire. He's got first down. We talked about the strength on strength, and it doesn't come more glaring than this. Second in the nation in scoring defense. Nobody scored more than 20. South Carolina in a double overtime win got 20. Meanwhile, LSU just keeps rolling along.
And that's exactly what Kirby told us. They put everything together that an NFL team like the Saints have, plus tempo. That's what makes it hard.
First down from the 37-yard line.
They run the New Orleans Saints offense, but with a college flair to it.
Edwards-Helaire in the slot to the left as a receiver across the middle. It's batted in the air. Joe Burrow to Joe Burrow. And now Burrow heading to the first down marker and then some. It's going to go as a Burrow to Burrow 16-yard pickup.
He's too good to be lucky, but on this one, he was lucky. Also, he's such an aware football player. As I said, his stats are amazing, but he actually plays better than his stats, and that's even hard to say.
Malik Herring got a hand on it, and then Joe Burrow got a hand on it. And they're in Georgia territory. Burrow looking for more, going deep. Man out there, tipped an incomplete intended for Ja'Marr Chase. And Eric Stokes was with him stride for stride.
And that's the matchup of the day for Georgia. How do they take Ja'Marr Chase away? They're going to match up a healthy Eric Stokes all over the field. Actually, Ja'Marr misjudged this football. And he's great at going up and catching those balls at the highest point. That one he slightly misjudged.
Second and 10 at the Georgia 47-yard line. And now Chase comes into the Tiger backfield. And we'll come in motion. And Burrow's going to keep it on a quarterback draw. Back to the line of scrimmage, and that's it. Devontae Wyatt made the tackle.
one of the reasons that Joe Burrow is going to try to run a little bit last year in their 36-16 win against Georgia. Joe ran the ball 10 times for 89 yards. He had a 15-yard gain in that game. Three sacks for a loss of 23, but he was effective running the ball.
First third and long for LSU. All the receivers packed in tight, including Thaddeus Moss, the tight end. On the right side is Burrow. Looking to throw deep down the middle, and he got it complete. Paris Marshall for the first down.
Boy, that's tough to do against Joe Burrow. Just a three-man rush against a guy. Watch, if you look at it, just three guys coming in here. A spy player, but he was not a rusher. And a wide open throw. You got a guy that completes 78% of his passes step into a throw. Bad news.
23-yard pickup.
Here's that run stuffing defense, though. And it was Tyler Clark that changed the line of scrimmage again. He's the guy. When you look at him, he doesn't have that defensive line body. But up front, watch them just move the line of scrimmage. Monty Rice is in the middle of it as well. Another emerging player.
DJ Daniel came around the corner to help on the tackle as well. No gain, second down attempt. Burrow and Edwards Elliott have a look to the sideline.
And LSU changes, Georgia changes their defense.
Play clock down to three. Just got it away. Burrow, plenty of time. Scanning the field, pointing. Wow. Now he's going to go deep. And caught. Jamar Chase for the touchdown.
You cannot rush three guys against Joe Burrow. I would say he had 6 or 7 seconds
at
to
least.
Throw that ball. As good as Eric Stokes is, you're not going to cover these receivers for that long. That strategy is going to have to change.
45th passing touchdown, a new SEC record. He was tied with 44. Didn't take long to break that here in Atlanta. Cade York in for the point after. I think they're going to take a review maybe and see if he caught this.
The ruling on the field was a completed catch for a touchdown. The previous play is under further review.
Oh, did the ball move after he came down? His elbow hit the ground, but I think he controlled it. Has it?
Ooh. Oh, boy. It's closer than I thought it was, that's for sure.
Is the ball moving when his hand hits the ground? He's got it.
That is a tough one.
You can see the ball wobble after his elbow hits the ground.
J.R. Reed trying to make the play defensively for Georgia, number 20. Gene Steratore is our rules official. Gene, what do you see?
Yes, Brad. On this one, Brad, I don't hear you very well. I've got something in my ear. Don't have anything. Sorry, Brad. What I've got right now is as he's possessing this ball, he's falling at the same time. So he has to survive the ground on this play. And I think the ruling on the field is very important right now because the ruling is touchdown. And I'm not seeing anything that could overturn that ruling on the field so far from the angles I have.
Yeah, it looks like a catch to me, too. The ball wobbles, but I don't think he loses control of it. Gene, I think you're right. Comes up with it in his right hand.
After review, the ruling on the field stands. Touchdown.
There you go. Touchdown.
Thank you, Gene. Good eye. I guess you do that for a living, right, Gene? I don't know. Kirby right now is going to look at Dan Lanning, his defensive coordinator. He said, you know those 4 days of practicing that three-man rush?
Yeah, let's forget that.
Yeah, we might have to relook at that.
Cade York in for the point after. Up and good. So just 6 minutes into the game, LSU covers 75 yards in eight plays.
Brad, we all played flag football, right? One Mississippi, two Mississippi. I think this got to at least seven or eight Mississippi before he threw the ball.
Maybe Louisiana's, I don't know, but it's a touchdown to Ja'Marr Chase, his 18th of the year, Joe Burrow's 45th of the year. The watch party in Joe Burrow's hometown, they're digging it right now. Tigers 7-0. Remarkable.
Yeah, all of us that watch LSU all year are remarkable everything this offense is doing. It's so different, and what a great turnaround Ed Orgeron has put on this football team.
Avery Atkins' kick will sail out of the end zone, and Jake Fromm and Georgia will come back out at the 25-yard line. And boy, Georgia tried to do it right away. First snap, deep ball. Tyler Simmons couldn't handle it. Deep sideline, running out of real estate over there. And then another would have been a awfully good catch by Robertson had he made it, but it's not like they didn't come out with guns blazing. Let's see what they do now.
And that has really been the story of this Georgia season. Young receivers that have not been making the plays that were so, you know, big plays a year ago with Miko Hardman and Riley Ridley and Jamiah Holloway. That guy right there being on the sideline is one of the reasons they have more inexperience in the game.
Lawrence Cager, surgery on his ankle this week. Here's James Cook on the handoff with Cook and Swift both in there together on that snap.
The thing that we have not talked a lot about in the open and all week is the improvement that Dave Aranda's defense has been making as the season is going along.
Yep.
They pitched a almost perfect game against Texas A&M, and he says, I got healthy players now, can do a lot of moving parts, and the biggest part of it is he has two corners that can play man-to-man defense, and he can kind of use his other nine guys like wild cards all over the field.
Those two being Derek Stingley and Christian Fulton. Empty backfield for Jake Fromm, who throws out of the flat. DeAndre Swift, can he get a first down? He's very close. I think they gave it to him.
Another well-designed play by offensive coordinator James Coley. He's had three potential big plays, but here's another great matchup that he's maneuvered, getting Swift on the safety, but this time Jacoby Stevens. There's James.
So DeAndre Swift with a catch out of the backfield, and Kirby Smart told us yesterday the backs are going to have to be a big part of the passing game. That's 22nd catch of the year for DeAndre, and good for a first down. At the 35. Swift, little stutter step, and the hurdle, but it only got him back to the line of scrimmage, but he went right over the top of Stingley. Well, playing with kind of a banged up shoulder, but nothing wrong with the spring in his legs.
But again, that LSU defense against the run, bouncing it outside with nowhere to turn up. So far, it has basically been a passing game for Georgia. I'm wondering if they can get to the edges running. It's an undersized defense. Can that offensive line make an impact? I think they have to.
Swift goes out. Brian Herrien will trot back over to meet Jake Fromm in the Dogs' backfield. Second and 10. Fromm incomplete. Too far in front, out of bounds. Kiaris Jackson was the intended receiver. A big difference for Jake Fromm when he's got Lawrence Cager out there and without him.
Yeah.
And he's about a 70% passer with Cager and Pickens. And he's been below 50% the last 3 or 4 weeks when those guys aren't out there.
And he didn't play at all against Texas A&M or Kentucky. And he only partially against South Carolina and Auburn. And that South Carolina game, not having him, really cost this football team their probably embarrassing loss of the season.
Fromm only 2 out of 6 to start. Third down and 10 for Georgia. Here comes the blitz. Georgia picks it up pretty well. Fromm throws just over.
It missed him.
Blaylock's hands.
They go all out blitz here. You know it's man-to-man coverage. You had him wide open just against a great team like LSU. Look how open and overthrow Dominic Blaylock. You're rushing, let's see, 5, 6 defenders. You know you've got man-to-man. You got good protection, and you don't hit him.
And Jake knows it.
He's the first one to know it. Jake Kamara to the punt.
And usually when you throw it, you know it as soon as you let it go.
Yeah. Yeah, they got close to Kamara. They actually knocked him down. And they look around. Is there going to be a flag? And Kamara kicks it into the end zone.
I think he was blocked into him, though.
Torrey Carter is a guy that kind of collided with number 90.
Yeah, Ben Cleveland, number 74, got the block, and Kirby's going to work the refs.
Let's take another look at it.
Watch Big 74 block him and right into him, and yeah. He tries to hold him up, but he can't.
Well, it's going to be LSU on offense with a touchdown lead at their own 20 when we come back. Done today as you take a look in at Mercedes-Benz Stadium in Atlanta. Our aerial coverage sponsored by State Farm. Let's check in with Jamie. Yeah, we might have a little trouble with Jamie's mic. We'll get back to her in a second. Joe Burrow sets up his offense at the 20-yard line after going 4 for 5 for 66 yards and a touchdown, including 4 different receivers, and that includes Joe Burrow of the 4 different receivers. First down from the 20. Georgia's saying that left tackle Sadiq Charles moved, and maybe they're going to get that call.
False start. Offense. Number 77. 5-yard penalty. First down.
I think we got Jamie now.
Yeah, I'm here. And Kirby Smart was also going back to what is in his blood. He was all over the secondary group in that last series, going up to each individual guy, referencing back to that interview, saying, get the hands on those guys, those wide receivers. We have to stay with them.
He was out there after practice yesterday just with his DBs.
Running
and everybody else had gone to the bus.
He was running routes, wasn't he? Against it.
So first and 15 at the 15 following the penalty. Extra rusher coming, Burrow. He's going to run with it now. And got 3 tough yards. J.R. Reed made the tackle.
One of the questions about Georgia's great stats this year was the quarterbacks they faced. A lot of first-year starters, true freshmen.
Wide receivers.
Starts, wide receivers. This guy is a class way above some of those stat-producing days.
Thaddeus Moss, the tight end, was in motion and settles in. And a slot on the left side on second down and 11. Play action. And Burrow's going to come back out to Edwards-Elair. He slipped and lost the ball. Georgia might have this. Lewis Seen, I think, is on top of the ball.
Well, yesterday we asked Kirby Smart, how are you going to stop Edwards-Elair? And he said, watch. You'll see. And the changeup has been Lewis Seen, number 16. He's basically running a spy on number 22. Ball is caught. Slip. Was he down? That's the question before the ball comes out.
You can see he covered it, caused it, and covered it. But
there's
was his
Seen
wrist down?
Spying number 22. Was he down?
A fumble recovered by the defense. The previous play is on a further review.
He has the ball. He puts his hand down, his left wrist. When his left wrist goes down, I think the wrist counts as being down.
Gene Steratore, what do you got, Gene?
This is really close, Brad, and Gary went to a very important point. What I think I'm seeing right now from one of our closer angles from the sideline is that I think it's potentially the forearm. Now, the forearm will put him down. The back of the hand will not. But as you look at that angle, if that moves and graduates to the forearm, then I think we have him down based on that contact there.
There it is. His left wrist hits the ball, and that jars the ball loose. Gene, are we together? Do you think it's going to go back to LSU? I do.
Yes, Gary, that's where I would go with this because the ground cannot cause a fumble. So if that forearm is down, then this play now is technically dead, and the loose ball that comes after that would be nullified because that forearm puts him down there.
You know, this field is loose. Those pellets that come out, you could see Edwards-Elair, who's a big-time cutter. He's so strong. Ness was talking in the pregame. Look at the size of his legs.
Yeah.
He tried to stick that foot in the ground, and it just gave way.
He is anxiously waiting on this call from James Carter.
After review, the runner's elbow was down prior to the fumble. It will be third down from the 14-yard line, LSU.
So it goes back to the Tigers, and a sigh of relief from their fans and from Clyde Edwards-Helaire.
His forearm, as Gene said, his forearm goes down. I thought it might be his left wrist, but the back of his left wrist goes down, called the forearm.
Might make note too, guys, this is a really good play on the officiating side. That ball comes out so quick in live speed that you are much safer there to rule fumble and now let replay fix it as it did correctly.
Now Georgia's defense will dig in and try to prevent a conversion on third down at 16. As Burrow and the offense have another opportunity here at the 6-10 mark.
See if they can get some pressure on Joe Burrow.
Empty backfield. Burrow with all those receivers up to the left. That's where he's going with the ball. Got it out complete to Justin Jefferson. Jefferson will be run down after a short gain by J.R. Reed.
Brad, we talked about that Kirby made junk that three-man rush. He brought five. And then after you see the ball gets out of his hands, watch five come. Well, watch how fast this Georgia defense runs. Fastest defense in the league this year.
Dominique Blaylock back to field Zach Rosenberg's punt. They got close. They knock him down. There's no flag. And Blaylock hands it off to the official with Georgia in good field position. That was only the 18th three and out of the season for LSU. Can you believe that?
I know, and it was Lewis Seen again, number 16, who got in there close. Tyler Simmons was there on the left side. Watch it. 16 and 87 came close.
Georgia with good field position, trailing by 7 when we return. And that's how to do Project Smarter, presented by the Home Depot, Garrett.
Well, to be smart, you have to have a game plan. That's where you start. You start out on Georgia's defense and saying, all right, we've got an idea. We're going to rush three, have a lot of coverage. So one of them gets completed like that. And then this one, we said, was it 7? Was it 8 seconds? It was actually more. It was 8.7 seconds. And you know what's really smart? Changing sometimes. Admit that you've got to do something different. And Kirby said, no. We're bringing 5 next time, and it worked.
There he is coaching up his defense. Meanwhile, the offense on the field at the 44-yard line. James Cook in the backfield behind Jake Fromm. And he'll hand it off to Cook, who got 2 or 3. Cook, a sophomore out of Miami. Younger brother of Dalvin Cook of the Minnesota Vikings, wearing his brother's old number when he was at FSU, also number 4. And now he goes split out as a receiver, and Zamir White comes into the Georgia backfield. No DeAndre Swift in this possession so far. White. Wow, he's still going. And you hear the chants of Zeus.
Yes. And the chants of Zeus is from the championship crowd here being in Atlanta is about, I'd say, 70% leaning towards Georgia. Bought a little more tickets, a little closer to the area right here, and probably the crowd noise would favor Georgia in this game.
Right. So a third down, but a shorter one for Georgia. 3rd and 3 as they're just shaded into LSU territory at the 49. Brian Herrien back in at tailback. LSU brings some extra people up close. Fromm to throw on 3rd and short. Waiting. Deep middle. Got it. Complete. Dominique Blaylock. And Blaylock holding his knee. Oh, boy.
Lined up in the slot that time. When Jake Fromm went to the outside, he got open. But after he caught it, you can see that knee twinged on him. He throws off the coverage, gets it, and then lands. Oh, boy.
And I don't think I've seen Kirby Smart come out on a field as fast as he just did.
Yeah, yep. You're up in midair. Your whole body comes down at the same time and transfers right to that joint.
Yep. Receiver down. Dominique Blaylock. We'll check out him when we come back.
Don't freak out, but you can get 50% off all.
Blaylock, the freshman out of Marietta, being helped off the field after making his 18th catch of the season, and that further shortens the receiving corps for
sure
Jake Fromm and company.
Yep. Cage already down. Pickens with the suspension.
It was a first down for Georgia. So back to the ground to White. And he only got about a yard. If you're wondering why George Pickens is not in the first half of this game, they've had some issues with him. First of all, he didn't start the first half of that Georgia Tech game because of rules of team violations. And then he got into this skirmish with Trey Swilling, and out he goes. And so he's out for the first half of this SEC championship game, and they could sorely use him right now. 3 minutes remaining in the first quarter. He'll be back for quarter number three. Second down and 9 for the Georgia offense at the 38-yard line of LSU. And that one's knocked down by Caleb on Chason. And he almost swallowed that ball up as Jake Fromm threw it right between the 1 and the 8 almost.
You want to watch some great battles inside. Trey Hill against Tyler Shaven right there. Shelvin against Hill. These two guys are monsters. They've been fighting every play. This time was a quick screen, so it really wasn't one-on-one, but Chason goes up and swats it back.
It was intended, or was going to be, for Demetrius Robertson.
The one thing Coach O said is we cannot lose the line of scrimmage.
Georgia picked up its last third down situation. There's a draw play to Harrier, and that's not going to cut it. They got it to the 35. It might have put it in field goal range, though, for Rodrigo Blankenship. There's the missing wide receivers.
Yeah, story of the season, that the young wide receivers kind of got Jake Fromm squeezing the ball a bit, and then it just kind of multiplied from there.
Rodrigo Blankenship has hit 3 field goals this year of more than 50. This will be from 52. A semifinalist. I should say a finalist for the Groza Award is the top kicker in the country. Let's see if he can score 3 for Georgia here from long range. Rodrigo Blankenship. And the whistle blow before the kick. Everybody just sort of stopped him. Kick is wide left. No good.
I think LSU was playing defense safe. They were not going to allow any trick play. And we've seen Kirby. He loves to come and steal a possession with his special teams. Well kicked, but it just kept turning, and obviously wide.
So a missed opportunity there from 52 yards. Just check in with Jamie.
We saw a big head shake from Kirby Smart when he checked in on Dominique Blaylock, and it seems to be some bad news here. He is getting carted off to the locker room. He's having trouble putting weight on that left leg, guys.
That's too bad, man. Championship game. Everything that goes with it. Here's Clyde Edwards-Helaire for a couple.
Well, that's Georgia has to hang their hat on stopping this running game as we watch. Actually, you know, one of the important players is Blaylock's the punt return guy.
That's right, exactly. And Dominique, whose daddy played for the Hawks here in the NBA, Mookie Blaylock. So a sad ending to his day for sure. Second and 8. They got a hit on Burrow, but not before he got it to Edwards-Helaire. Good enough for a first down.
I just get the feeling like on half of the pass plays, he looks where Helaire at first. Now, this was a hot. He read that blitz all the way, and he stayed ahead of it. And just Monty Rice comes in and goes, you can hit me if you want, but I'll take a first down.
First down it is at the 48-yard line. Now the play fake to Edwards-Helaire and going deep left sideline. Coverage is a caught, yes, Terrace Marshall. Or did he drop it?
Well, he double caught it if he caught it. Ball was underthrown.
Yeah, he caught it twice.
Badly. Oh, right off his chest, but good enough to grab it and keep it.
And now they go tempo at the 11-yard line.
And Georgia's going to be offsides. Even if nothing gains, it's going to be 5 yards and first down again. Georgia tried to substitute, and that tempo got him.
I think they're going to take the run.
Yeah.
It's about 8 yards.
Actually, the last guy coming was offside and 12 men on the field. Watch the last player
prior to the snap. Offside.
defense number 13, was in the backfield prior to the snap. 5-yard penalty, first down.
So again, first it was the catch that got him down to the 11-yard line. Another look at it from Terrace Marshall.
Hit him right in the left shoulder. Covered that time by Campbell. Decent coverage, ball underthrown. Those are the toughest ones to handle if you're a defensive back.
The one thing Georgia did not want to do is fall a couple of scores behind this group. Edwards-Elair, they're going to drag him down for a loss of one. Tay Crowder just kept spreading it out there, got help from his friends.
I'll tell you, Tay Crowder and Monty Rice, they are two athletic inside linebackers. Tay Crowder started his career at Georgia as a running back, and he has moved into the linebacker spot and has that speed.
There's the fake, there's the lob, there's a wide open Terrace Marshall. Touchdown, LSU.
The design on this play. They go the bunch, and that confuses Georgia. A short, tight bunch. He's right here. He comes inside and back out, and Joe says, oh yeah, this is real easy. J.R. Reed did not have a chance.
Extra point by Cade York coming up. And it's up and good. And for the 58th time this year, an offensive touchdown drive of less than 3 minutes for the Red Hot Tigers of LSU. 65 yards in five plays, 7-yard touchdown pass. Burrow's second scoring toss of the day. And it's LSU 14-0. Back at Mercedes-Benz Stadium, it's 14-0, and Joe Burrow has thrown his 45th and 46th touchdown passes of the year. I mentioned the under 3 minute drive earlier. There you see the graphic. And that's out of 76 offensive touchdowns. And Georgia's going to have to work now. Two touchdowns back from their own 25-yard line. Cedric the Entertainer and Max Greenfield star in a new neighborhood Monday night at 8, 7 Central on CBS. The Georgia Bulldogs basically in their own neighborhood, about 70 miles from Athens here in Atlanta, but it's not helping them so far.
For all of you that didn't see the LSU-Alabama game, Brad is a really tough grader. And he had stats similar to this, and Brad said he's having an average game, so he's having another average game.
I didn't say he's almost perfect. He just happened to be 13 out of 13 at the time, okay?
You got it.
You know, maybe he didn't shave that day. Come on.
But he's looking good again, and if you give him time to throw, he's going to beat you.
Jake Fromm's got to answer the call here. Here's a toss to Brian Harry. Harry, good run. Out for about 9. So again, limited duty so far. Kind of a quiet Mercedes-Benz Stadium right now because it's 14-0 LSU. And we'll return to Atlanta after this message and a word from your local station. SEC championship game, and LSU off to a tremendous start through the first 15 minutes. Joe Burrow throwing a couple of touchdown passes. Remember the year that Larry Bird won the three-point shooting contest?
Yes.
At the NBA All-Star game? He put the three up and then he just walked halfway to the locker room. Joe Burrow just threw that ball and got, I know that's a touchdown. I'm just going to head over here and relax.
I know, but that wasn't even three. It was almost like a layup. He let that one go. He knew he couldn't miss that one.
So, second and a yard for Georgia to open up quarter number two.
Let's see if that offensive line can make a difference. Last year in the third loss to LSU, they felt they lost both sides of the ball on the offensive line.
Jake Fromm under center for the first time gives it to Samir White, and if he got it, he really had to fight for it, I can tell you that much. So a 14-0 hole that the Dogs have dug themselves into, partner. And you know, they went for a 52-yard
right.
field goal, trying to get something, and it gave them a short field.
Well, a short field, but you got to. I mean, as many points as LSU scores right. in this game, and Ricardo had the leg, he just missed it, but you're right. After that, then, you got to deal with a short field and a powerful offense.
And it's still third down and short. This time, number 3 gets it. Didn't get much, but he got enough to move the chains.
And LSU has their second defensive line in the game. No starters. They're already going through their first rotation in the defensive line.
So Georgia started early by trying to throw deep on a couple of occasions, a couple of them that maybe could have been big plays, should have been caught, that type of thing. Now they are hesitant here about who's going to be in the backfield. DeAndre Swift comes in, but he just immediately goes to a wide receiver spot.
One correction, Tyler Shelvin, 72, is in at nose tackle, and he is a difference maker.
Now Swift will join Fromm. Actually going to just dump it off to him. DeAndre Swift trying to get to the edge. Spins inside, got good yardage out to the 44-yard line. That'll go as a completion from Fromm to Swift.
Well, I tell you, DeAndre Swift, when we saw that game against Texas A&M, he was basically the offense that day. The only dependable player. You could see his skills on that run.
Fromm throws, got it complete to Simmons for a first down into LSU territory. At the 41.
Now you got bump and run, and you got to attack bump and run. And this time Simmons beats him at the line of scrimmage. Stingley forces a good throw, and Jake Fromm puts it right there, and Simmons catches this one.
Georgia going tempo here a little bit. At least they got up to the line of scrimmage rapidly at the 41 of LSU.
And LSU has substituted their first team defensive linebacker in the game.
Play action, Fromm loads. Throws complete. Robertson has got another first down. He's collared and dropped at about the 24, but Georgia's got something moving here.
Well, that time Robertson was matched up against Kerry Vincent, the third actually safety corner in the game, and he beats him cleanly. Might have pushed off, but he got away with it.
Now you're going to hear boos from the Georgia fans because Tyler Shelvin is down.
And if he's really hurt, and he may be, that would be something that the Georgia fans don't want to boo, because he's one of their difference makers up front, and it looks to me like he is.
Tyler Shelvin, Gary was just talking about him, the sophomore out of Lafayette, Louisiana, down on the play. Tyler Shelvin helped off after that last play. Meanwhile, Georgia has a first down at the 24-yard line. Trailing by two touchdowns. Jake Fromm this drive three for three for 39 yards, looking for more. Jake throws, corner, Herrion intended receiver, and it's incomplete.
Boy, if he had just stayed inside, he had Karis Jackson, number 10, breaking to the middle of the field. He made his mistake, made his decision just a little early. Watch number 10 get to the middle of the field. Might have had him. Might have been that Delpit turned as the ball was thrown, but it was close. Good coverage on the play.
Brings up second down and 10, so the first incompletion for Fromm on this series for Georgia. Zamir White in again at tailback for Georgia. And he's going to get the carry, and he's going to get swallowed up by Rashad Lawrence.
He's a warrior. He may be one of my most favorite players I've covered in the SEC. Plays hurt, plays hard. He's not the most skilled player in athletically, but boy, he looked pretty good there, didn't
he? Did. The senior captain out of Monroe, Louisiana.
He doesn't have those measurables, you know, running a 4.8 or anything like that, but he just continues to make plays throughout his whole career. Saw him play a game a year ago on one ankle.
Ever since Shelvin slowed down the momentum that Georgia had going, Georgia's going the wrong way. Third down at 14 now.
They got to put some points on the board here. They got to get at least a field goal.
Fromm, pressure coming. Throws complete. Simmons got a little bit of it back.
Good smart play that time by Derek Stingley Jr. He was willing to concede the short play. Decent protection. Let him catch it. Make the tackle. And he did.
So Rodrigo Blankenship will come out. He's 24 of 29 on the year. He missed just a few minutes ago from 52 yards. This will be a 39-yard attempt by the former walk-on and now leading scorer in Georgia history. And he's got three more to that record. Georgia gets on the board with just under 11 and a half to go in the first half. LSU 14, Georgia 3 here in Atlanta. And for LSU in that spot where they could maybe move in and be one of the four. There's Q, more affectionately known around here as UGA 10. And Harry Dog behind him. Steve Emsinger and Joe Brady. Joe Brady up for the Broyles Award.
Here's Joe Brady, and there's the veteran Steve Emsinger.
Got an interesting match here. Brady's up for the Broyles Award as top assistant coach, one of five. And Dan Lanning, on the other hand, for Georgia, is also up for it from his defensive coordinator position. Rodrigo Blankenship kicks it out of the end zone, and LSU will go to work at the 25-yard line. Joe Burrow, just a 9 out of 10 day for 123 and 2, Gary.
Yeah, and when you blitz him, he's a decision maker, gets rid of the ball, goes deep, underthrow, not a great pass, but they've got skilled receivers, and they got three of them, and then that Joe Brady design right here. Look at this one. As Brad said, he threw it and turned and walked to the bench, and why not? He had a layup.
Seven straight completions on that drive. Looking for more right here. From the 25, Edwards-Helaire will flush out of the backfield. Burrow goes back the other way, completes it. Racy McMath, who's come into the picture as another receiver in that talented receiving core, makes the catch. Let's test your knowledge with today's Aflac trivia question. But four players have won the Heisman Trophy, the SEC Championship game, and the National Championship in the same season.
And I can admit I did not know this one.
I didn't either. I think we got to
two or three. Yeah.
Second and six at the 29. Burrow in trouble a little bit for the first time all game. He's going to throw out of bounds. Got rid of it before he was sacked by, would have been Monty Rice had he gotten to him. Malik Herring was also coming around the corner.
You know, our own Rick Neuheisel has been comparing Joe Burrow to Tom Brady. The only thing different that I see, he's got a lot of traits, is he's a little bit more athletic than Tom Brady was when I covered him at Michigan.
Empty backfield for Brady on third down and six. Fans are trying to help the Georgia defense here a little bit.
How many will they bring? Three.
Only three. Burrow has loved that three-man rush, and he's going long. Out there, off the hands of Terrace Marshall.
Yes, touchdown.
Mark Webb was there, but the ball was right in his hands.
Well, now both teams have dropped a big pass, and this one was huge for Georgia because if he catches it, the score is going to be 21-3. One-on-one, middle of the screen, out of position. That's the easiest catch you'll have right there, right in the face mask, and he kind of gets his hands going backward on that one, and a clean drop.
The second three and out for LSU today. Ron Rosenberg's punt, fair catch, taken and captured back there by Tyler Simmons, who's in there with Blaylock not being able to go as the punt returner.
That was an interesting three and out. Georgia gets credit for a three and out, but it was almost a touchdown.
It sure was. And Joe knows it. That would have been his third. As it is, 14-3. Mercedes Benz Stadium with the roof closed here. The SEC Championship game. Here's a look at Terrace Marshall, what would have been his second touchdown of the day, I can guarantee you.
Yep, went right off his left, the kind of index finger, or maybe ring finger would be more accurate. He
goes
to the bench.
He goes over to Joe Burrow and says, man, that was my fault. And I think Joe is saying, I got you. We'll get you next time.
And how big was that? Finally, a break going Georgia's way.
Yeah.
Because that one might have been death right there, 21-3.
Tyler Shelvin, by the way, is back in on the defensive front in the middle.
Along with Lawrence and Logan, they got their number one guys in there up front.
And Georgia down an extra receiver. If you missed it earlier, Dominic Blaylock injured. They don't get George Pickens back until the third quarter. So it's next man up for Georgia. First down at the 21. Harry going nowhere. there. Stingley with the tackle as we check in with Jamie.
Hasn't Jake Fromm faced a lot of criticism so far this season? He feels like at times it was his lowest points. And we asked Kirby Smart how he handled that with his quarterback. He said, this is a guy that's a type A personality. He needs reassurance at times. I told him, your best is as good as we can have. Your good is even good when we have it. But Jake said at times it was challenging, but he is so happy to be on the stage now.
Yeah, and Kirby also said, we're pretty much the same kind of personality. So I take a lot on my shoulders. Jake's got a lot on his shoulders. There's his numbers from the last drive that netted them 3 points. Draw play. Perry. Got about four.
Tyler Shelvin and Jacoby Stevens. One of those safeties. It's a nickel package for LSU. And those number three and number seven are always in the action. Inside, number 72 throws them away, but look who's there. Jacoby Stevens reads it quickly.
Stevens basically a linebacker earlier in the year. Now one of the leaders in that secondary that includes Delpit and Fulton and Stingley and company.
And look what's happening to this Georgia wide receiver group. They're having to play Landers. They're having to play Samir White and Cook to cover up for the injuries at wide receiver.
Third down and five.
And suspensions.
Simmons in motion. Again. Fromm. Pressure coming from behind. Got it to Herrien out in the flat. First down for Brian Herrien. Might have gotten face mask, but he's still standing.
Well designed. Give this one offensive coordinator James Coley. He schemed up a great play and had an easy throw. A lot of shift in motion. Goes one way, and then he gets Herrien out. Easy leverage right there. He gets outside. There's no way Patrick Queen could get it the coverage.
We've seen Brian Herrien as a receiver make some really nice catches this year.
Yeah, remember that Florida game? Yeah. He did that one-handed bobble to himself.
Yep. Got a couple on the ground on that one. Stevens made the stop. Second down and eight coming up as we're under 8.5 in the quarter.
Well, that last drive for 3 points. Just as important as the 3 points was 10 plays. Keeping the ball away from Joe Burrow is part of the, has to be part of the game plan for this Georgia football team.
Zamir White back in for Georgia. Two tight end set. Joe Burrow looks on. Jake Fromm under center. Hasn't been there that often so far in the first half. Play action. Look out. Down he goes. It's Delpit with a sack.
Well, one of the most creative defensive coordinators in college football is the defensive coordinator for LSU, Dave Aranda. And this time, Delpit times it perfectly. No one there. And when Jake Fromm turns around, it's a sack. And Aranda just earned part of that. What does he get, $2 million a year?
Yeah, somewhere in there. Not a lot of sacks given up by Georgia, but that one was a 9-yard bullet by Delpit.
And only 9 sacks all year, but that one and Jake Fromm on the turf.
He has been Mr. Durable as his 3 years as a starter. And boy, you talk about a huge blow to Georgia's chances. If
one of the things you do have to do as a quarterback, if you feel a twinge, you get hurt, you see his right ankle got bent from behind, you cannot come out. I was a backup quarterback. You've got to give me some throws on the sideline. So watch, he gets his ankle rolled up. He starts to limp. You can't limp off. You got to give the backup quarterback 6-8 throws and some snaps just to get used to the situation.
And that backup quarterback would be Stetson Bennett, who has not seen a lot of work. And again, that was just ugly all the way around, unless you're Grant Delpit and an LSU fan. And there's Jake trying to walk it off.
Yeah. Left ankle.
Wow.
Well, in some games here, backup quarterbacks have hurt Georgia in this stadium. Could a backup quarterback save them this time for Georgia?
Well, Stetson Bennett, he's in his second stint as Georgia, at Georgia. Started off here as a freshman, then went to Jones County Community College in Mississippi. And now back for a second time, and you saw the numbers that he's put up, 20 out of 26 for a couple of touchdowns. But every Georgia fan in here is either biting their fingernails or holding their breath, and Jake's going, all right, we're going to be okay, let's go. So here comes Stetson Bennett.
And right now, Kirby has to figure out a way to get his team out of this half. keeping it close enough when they get Pickens back in the second half and maybe get Jake Fromm back a little healthy. Oh. Talking about the backup quarterbacks, right, Ness?
Yeah. 1 year it was the national championship game. Tua Tagovailoa took over, and then Tua got hurt last year, and Jalen Hurts comes in, and that touchdown is what ended it, 35-28. So now it's Georgia's backup quarterback in the spotlight. You could see him on the sideline going, give me the play, give me the play. Running a lot of plays for third and 17. They might just play this close to the vest. I guess not. They're going to let him throw. Down the middle. Overthrew. Lucky.
That was almost a disaster.
Yep. So they will punt.
He went for Matt Landers over the middle of the field. The ball sailed on him, and he's very fortunate that this one wasn't a disaster for the Georgia football team.
Jacoby Stevens had his sights on it.
Tries to throw to number five. He's got him open. Just doesn't get it to him.
And there's Stevens, who did get a hand on it. And now it's Kamara to punt. And the Georgia injury tent has been too busy in this first half with key players, including their quarterback. Kamara's kick. Stingley backpedals, just lets it go, and it's going to make the end zone. And that's a big difference. And Kamara knows if he could have pulled the string on that just a little bit, it would have put LSU in a tough spot.
He had a huge game against Auburn. He had 11 punts in that game. Kept him in the game by punting in that day.
He did. Again, Georgia not only trailing 14-3, but more importantly, number 11, who's been their leader for 3 years, down and we hope not out. Lead 14-3, Zook, right now. Earlier we asked you the Aflac trivia question, which Gary and I and Jamie admitted that it's kind of a tough one for us.
It's tricky because of one name that's not on here. I thought Tebow's name would be on here. Forgot it was in a different year, right?
That's right. So there it is. Derrick Henry, Mark Ingram from Alabama, Danny Werfel from Florida, and Cam Newton from Auburn all won the SEC title and the national championship.
Well, this
Heisman.
Yep, this defense has carried Georgia all year. They have to get them to the second half. Can they get a stop? Maybe even do a little bit more than a stop for the defense to help the Georgia team.
They'd like one of those havoc plays that Kirby is always preaching about. Burrow throws, got it to Thaddeus Moss for about a 5-yard gain as we check in with Jamie.
Well, Jake Fromm still in the medical tent for Georgia. Several players, including DeAndre Swift, have gone in to check on him. His helmet, though, is in the hands of one of the medical staff, so take from that as you will.
Okay. Well, right now, as Gary said, the Georgia defense has to do its job.
Remember, LSU gets the ball in the second half. They get an extended drive here.
Blitz coming, and it almost paid off. Edwards-Helaire is hit, and gets back to the line of scrimmage, but Richard LeClaire went right over the top of him.
You got it. Dan Lanning and Kirby Smart's defense matched LSU's with a safety blitz that time against the run game, and LeCount was the guy in there early.
LSU trying to go tempo, and they got tangled up with a couple of people. Here's a wide open Justin Jefferson down the sideline. LeCount will bring him out of bounds, but not before he gets a first down.
And Georgia's going to try to substitute again. They better be careful. Looks like they're going to get it done. Hurry up this time, and it worked great. Got that bunch formation, but in the backfield that time was Jefferson. That was what gave Georgia problems.
Burrow throws out complete to Chase. Chase will be brought down short of the first down.
Ness, you know what it seems to me is that Georgia has spent a lot of time trying to stop Edwards-Helaire. They brought in an extra safety, Lewis Seen, number 16. They're bracketing him, and what it's done is opened up the wide receivers. They're spending so much time stopping 22, made for easy throws downfield.
A heated Kirby Smart on the sideline as here is Edwards-Helaire to the, maybe the 46. Let's check into Jamie again.
Jake Fromm has emerged from the medical tent. That left ankle is heavily taped, but he just greeted all of the offensive linemen and gave them all an "I'm okay, guys."
All right, so it looks like Jake will come back in. And Georgia's got another veteran player down. Michael Barnett, the nose man out of Ridgeville, South Carolina.
And we were looking, remember that third down pass to Justin Jefferson? We were looking at it over here on my other monitor I have. Actually, Georgia was running a guy off the field. They only had 10 men on the field on that third down conversion.
And it was a wide open guy on the far side for the first down. So Jake Fromm warming up. Got a smile on his face. That's a good sign. Charlie Werner there, the tight end, helping him. His roommate, who caught a touchdown pass against Georgia Tech last week. Meanwhile, looks like maybe a hamstring or a cramp. Michael Barnett.
He's right here.
Well, he was right in the mix of everything.
Yep. So it's third and short. Remember in last year's win, LSU actually went 4-for-4 on fourth down. Yeah. It was a big part of that football game. And Burrow on these third and very shorts likes to quarterback sneak it.
Don't forget, coming up, Adam, Rick, and BJ will have first half analysis, scores, and highlights on the Geico Halftime Report. The guys over to our right down in the end zone. And Barnett goes off. Jordan Davis comes in for him.
He's a load, especially on a quarterback sneak. Jordan Davis, number 99.
330 pounds of the sophomore out of Charlotte.
I guess he's not going to quarterback sneak.
Well, not unless he quarterback draws it from there. Or comes up under center, which he might. Oh, going to backpedal. Third and one.
Boy, look at him use that clock. He knows exactly how much time he has.
And now he will sneak it. Waited till the very end to come up under center and got the first down.
Interesting. He tried to draw him off sides to get a cheap first down. I think all along he was going to be a quarterback sneak. Got a little push from behind.
I don't even think he needed the push.
Maybe I shouldn't use little with Clyde Edwards-Helaire.
Yeah.
Short, but not little. I'll tell you that.
Joe Burrow, who has admitted, I like getting hit once in a while. It makes me feel like a football player. And he is a football player who happens to be a sensational quarterback on top of it. So first down at the 44. Jefferson in motion will set up in the left slot. Under 4 minutes to play in a half. Here comes pressure on Burrow. He got away from it somehow, and now he's running. This is what he does best. All the way to the 30-yard line.
Monty Rice had him nailed with the blitz inside, and that to me is the difference in Joe Burrow and the comparisons to like Tom Brady. Tom Brady doesn't have that. I'll tell you, that is an athletic play and one of the reasons why he's so special.
Now he's going right back to the air, and he's going for all of it, and he's in and out of the hands of Ja'Marr Chase.
Perfect job by the safety that time coming across. Richard LeCount was able to get enough pressure on the play to help DJ Daniel. He's got a chance. He's getting tugged from behind. You see the grab? Remember what Kirby told Jamie. Get our hands on him. And it worked on that play. Got away with one, Georgia did right there.
Burrow in the gun. Second down and 10. Edwards-Helaire with him. Three wideouts and the tight end Moss in the slot right. Using all of that play clock again. Burrow throws calmly to the 25, complete to Derek Dillon. It'll bring up third down.
I'll tell you, every time Clyde Edwards-Helaire goes out, he's taking two guys with him. He goes the other way and throws the easy slant.
You don't see double teams on a running back very often.
Nope.
And Georgia's going to take a timeout. 3:06 remaining in the second quarter. 14-3. LSU will be back in 30 seconds. Joe Burrow's mom and dad, Jimmy and Robin, obviously here. Pretty proud parents. Jimmy texted me this morning and said, I had to take a picture outside the Smile Direct iCruiser this morning over by the Hall of Fame. There he is. Had to get a picture with the three of us.
That's not bad.
That's good.
Well, I said Georgia needed to get out of the half. A stop here gets them out of the half.
Third down at 4. Can Georgia get that stop? Burrow's going to run with it all the way. He's really close, but he didn't get it. It's 4th and 1. Now, does Ed Orgeron have a decision to make or not?
He ran the field goal team on.
So the decision's already been made. Trying to make it 17-3.
Interesting call there. They ran the quarterback draw, and Georgia was ready for it.
Cade York is a true freshman, but he's been good. 18 out of 21 on the year.
Last year's game, Cole Tracy hit 5 field goals to extend the lead against Georgia.
York had 5 against Texas A&M last week. Can he hit this one from 41? That is up and good. Cade York tacks on 3 more for number 2 LSU, leading Georgia now 17-3. Can't think about that right now, man.
Make that transition with the music?
It's the music.
It's the music. Yeah.
Joe Burrow just led a 57-yard drive in 11 plays, capped by York's 41-yard field goal. And now Avery Atkins for kick. And Brian Harrigan just lets it fly. And now we've got a taste of tradition presented by Sonic. Here's Jamie.
Well, Brad, this year's SEC Football Legends class includes 14 inductees who brought success to their respective universities. The group is highlighted by 8 All-Americans and 4 national champions. Legendary Georgia coach Vince Dooley was among those honored. He guided the Bulldogs to over 200 wins and the 1980 national championship. In 1982, he coached Heisman Trophy winner Herschel Walker. Johnny Robinson of LSU starred on both sides of the ball for the Tigers. He earned his first team All-SEC honors in 1958, the same year LSU won their first national title.
Remember Johnny Robinson? They used to call him the Candy Man because he'd be stealing back there in the secondary for the Chiefs. Here's the throw, incomplete, intended for Tyler Simmons. And Jake Fromm back in there.
Yep. DeAndre Swift and Jake Fromm in there. In these situations in the past, I always used to think Georgia would go tight end. Remember Azagnata?
Yep.
He'd be going down the field, but just new players. Warner and Wolf are just a little bit different. We saw Eli Wolf make that big catch against Florida.
Yep.
To put that game away, and they're in there.
Second down and 10. Charlie Warner, the tight end, is at a group of 3 on the left side. The throw is across the middle there. It's Tyler Simmons. Simmons, he ran out of bounds, but he got a first down.
Clavon Chase on that time dropped too deep. He covered grass and not players. Watch him come back and run right by Simmons. You know, you can't cover grass. When you're in zone, you got to look for somebody. And that time, he let that first down happen.
Longest play of the day for Georgia at 19 yards. And down the middle, and it is the tight end, Charlie Warner.
He always goes that way. That situation, he loves those tight ends. Warner, who had his first career touchdown pass against Georgia Tech, and right there, he gets it.
Charlie, of course, the nephew of the great Scott Warner, who was a defensive back on that 80 national championship team that Jamie was talking about earlier for Vince Dooley. Timeout, 1:46 remaining, second quarter. Georgia on the move. Looking at the city of Atlanta, full of Georgia fans and LSU fans for this SEC championship game. 17-3 LSU with 1:46 remaining in a half.
Can you feel the pressure on this Georgia offensive drive right here? They know LSU's getting the ball to the second half. I mean, the way that LSU offense is going, Fromm needs to get points, and he's doing well so far. He's pulled his percentage up for 10 for 18. Looks like he's getting his feel back.
You saw DeAndre Swift have a little word with Jake, like, maybe get me the ball, Jake. First down. Fromm, pressure coming, throws far side. It's intercepted by Stingley.
His ball skills are unbelievable for a young player. A year from now, he will be playing both ways for LSU.
The 5th interception of the season for the true freshman.
And watch how late he turns around and finds the ball and makes the play. Watch, he turns at the last second and finds it and makes the catch.
One-handed.
On teachable skills. Defensive backs are usually there. They have trouble making those catches. Perfect catch. Holds off the receiver and makes the interception.
Jake had gone all the way since the South Carolina game without throwing an interception. It's only his 4th of the year, but it's certainly costly.
How aggressive will LSU be here? Minute 39, 2 timeouts.
That's a lifetime for them.
I know.
Burrow looking for more. Got some late pressure, crossing Rotto to Edwards-Helaire on the run. Clyde Edwards-Helaire all the way out to the 37-yard line.
Just look at the calmness here from Joe Burrow. He looks to his right, first receiver, not there. Second receiver, not there. Oh, give me my check down. I know I got him. And he gets in there for a huge play.
24-yard pickup for number 22 on the reception.
It's like you're playing against an NFL quarterback here for your Georgia. This is not a freshman quarterback.
Yeah, he's going to be an NFL quarterback very soon. A minute and a half to go in the half. Little hesitation, late blitz coming from Georgia. Burrow goes for chase and completes. Had a half step there, but a little too far in front of him.
Jake still limping. You can see it, the left ankle. Every time he steps, you can see that little gait he has, a little tilt every time.
You saw the graphic. First interception since that South Carolina game, a long string.
You can see scene right here is covering 22 all over the field. Safety on a running back, not a linebacker.
Second and 10. Burrow steps up in the pocket. Now he's going to take off with it. Burrow's going to get a first down and then some.
Man, look at him run away. Those are fast 4- and 5-star safeties and DBs. He looks every bit as comfortable, as fast as the guys that are chasing him. This time, Lewis C, number 16, tries to catch him, can't catch him.
17 yards on the run by Burrow. Devontae Wyatt is the Georgia player down. And again, they're stretching that leg out much like they did earlier.
To Michael Barnett,
Barnett, yeah.
Yes, 94-95. That's just amazing to watch Joe Burrow, you know, kind of break the mold of what a quarterback looks like. I mean, he's got the whole package. Tremendous leader, toughness. He brought toughness to this LSU team. Remember that Fiesta Bowl when he got hit against Central Florida?
Yep.
He won the team over with that one.
He said to us, what was I supposed to do? Just lay there and not come back and play?
And his skill set, I mean, he's having a bad day today, 15 for 20.
He has 4 first downs today, 3 on the ground and 1 as a receiver. Remember, he threw a pass that got batted back to him, and he picked up that. And another one right there, 17-yard rumble.
And when he runs, he's running against, I think, the fastest defense in the SEC.
And Devontae Wyatt is not going to be fast going to the sideline. Whether it was a hamstring or a cramp, we don't know exactly. But
that first play, when Burrow calmly waited for his third checkdown and he got the ball to Edwards-Helaire, really sparked this drive right here.
189 through the air, 2 touchdowns.
Yeah, and it's so far it's only taken him 24 seconds to get this far.
Yep.
41 yards in 24 seconds.
And a first down at the Georgia 46. Edwards-Helaire will come out of the backfield as a receiver up to the top of your screen. Short to Edwards-Helaire, who bobbled a little bit but did make the catch. Short gain. Burrow wants a timeout with a little over a minute left in the half. That'll be the second LSU timeout.
You know, that's the difference of the rules in the college. In the NFL, you might save your timeout there, but since any first down is going to stop the clock, they're not quite as valuable as they are in the NFL. That's that first drive starter here. That's what you need, a drive starter. And this time he just calmly surveys the field. Looks to his right. He knows his check down is right here. And he gets inside scene. And then he knows his third choice is a potential big play.
That's always a good choice.
Yes, it is. Now that's that Alvin Kamara factor that Joe Brady was with the New Orleans Saints. He had Kamara, and that's what Edwards-Helaire brings to this offense. But number 9 right there just looks like he's in total control.
Yep. Edwards-Helaire, they've held him in check as a running back. He's only got 12 yards rushing, but he's got 5 catches. There's Joe Brady, the passing game coordinator, in the middle of the 3. Second down and 6. Just inside the Dogs 42-yard line. They bring an extra man. Burrow just calmly walks away from that, but they're going to get him from behind.
And he dropped the ball, didn't he?
There's a battle for it right now, but the head linesman says he was down. He might still have it at the bottom of the pile anyway. Malik Herring and Nolan Smith are the two guys that ran him down. And there the ball popped out, but it looks like maybe his elbow was down right about there.
Yep. Nolan Smith, another one of those true freshmen to come in on their fourth. Look at him with his left hand grabbing for that ball because he didn't know if it was a fumble or not. He's just blindly looking for it. But Nolan Smith, number four, is going to be a future star rush guy. He comes in their third down package.
That's the last timeout for LSU with 51 seconds remaining in the quarter. And again, as Gary mentioned earlier, LSU gets the football first to start the third. There's a loose coach right there.
Yeah.
He was yesterday when we met with him.
How about his vision that he's had for this program?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, he came in when he got the head coaching job. I think he saw two things. He said, our line of scrimmage is not good enough on the offensive line or defensive line. He says, you know what we got to do? Recruit. And he has. And our passing game is not good enough to win in modern football. You know what we got to do? Recruit. And he recruited a couple Joes, Joe Brady and Joe Burrow.
Well said. Third down at five. Desperate for a stop is the Georgia defense.
It's man to man. They're coming after him.
Burrow calmly throws to Chase on the slant. And he's still running to the 30-yard line.
And that's why the timeouts are used wisely, because a first down stops the clock. Plenty of time.
That one was right on the money. Jefferson, the last guy back to the line of scrimmage for the Tigers. And Burrow going long and out there and broken up.
Nice play.
Terrace Marshall and DJ Daniels,
yes,
in coverage.
The ball was just slightly underthrown, but DJ Daniels was right there. Didn't lose any perspective, kept his eye on the ball, and with his right hand swats it away. Beautiful play by DJ Daniel.
Played out last year at JUCO at Georgia Military College. One of the 2 years he put in there and became,
yeah,
an instant starter here.
So many of those defensive backs in that position panic and grab. But that time he kept and just kept his eye on the ball.
Still 30 seconds left for the LSU offense here.
This is Thaddeus Moss right here, the tight end. That's the pressure that they put on this defense. Tight ends and running backs lining up all over.
Burrow down the middle. Incomplete. Intended for Jefferson. And now it's third and 10.
I think it was Jermaine Johnson, number 11, that was in the coverage that time. Blitz package over the middle of the field. Made it a tough throw. Good defense again by Georgia.
Boy, if the number one defense in the conference and the number two defense in the country has ever come up with a third down stop, Georgia would love one right here.
Well, those last two plays by this defense were huge.
Burrow has not been sacked today. Right now, Georgia would just like an incompletion or something short of a Tiger first down. Third and 10. Burrow scanning the field again as all day. Throws late, knocked down. Nice job defensively by Georgia's secondary.
N'Kobe Dean, another true freshman, I think number 17, is matched up against Edwards-Helaire. Another one of those great athletes coming on the field, recruited by Kirby, and he stays with him the whole way. Three really good defensive plays by this Georgia defense to keep him in the game.
N'Kobe Dean, the true freshman in high school, he was the Butkus Award winner as the best high school linebacker last year. Just made a big stop.
Yeah, athletic ability right there.
Cade York will try 40, I think a 48-yard field goal. And it's going to be wide left. Georgia got a much-needed stop there. So both kickers have missed from long range.
And I think getting to the second half, that Georgia locker room is going to feel good about themselves. Holding LSU, they've got a lot of yards, but only 17 points.
And the Georgia fans react behind that goalpost.
255 yards, but only 17 points. The name of the game is points, not yards.
Jake Fromm will come out Georgia has two timeouts remaining, but I don't think they're going to get too flashy here at 14 seconds. But
no,
we'll see.
No, I wouldn't. I mean, I'd consider taking a knee, to tell you the truth.
I would, too, if my quarterback had a bad ankle. And they do.
Well, look,
he does.
LSU, remember, against the Alabama team, they stayed bump and run in the situation. They're bump and run again.
So maybe Georgia will take a shot here. Brown's going to throw it. Quick slant behind his intended receiver, Robertson.
Yeah, I don't quite understand why Dave Aranda likes to do that. He actually gave a late touchdown to Alabama to kind of keep that game closer than it appeared at that. And here you are with 11 seconds to go, and you're playing press coverage. I know there's two safeties back there, but you really want somebody to gut you up the middle the way Blankenship can kick field goals? I'd back off and make the ball caught underneath you. They have
That's
now.
What they're going to do now.
Yes.
Let's see where Fromm can get a completion underneath, if he can get a pass away. And now he's over the line of scrimmage, I think. Completes it. The Georgia fans are going to get excited, but I think this thing's coming back. Landers goes out of bounds.
Now remember, his whole body has to be past the line of scrimmage. That means even his back foot has to be behind the scrimmage, and the clock's run out anyway. Maybe. We've seen this before, though. Right?
Don't give me another second this week, okay?
Let's see. Yes, if the blue line is correct, and we assume it is, he was clearly across the line. His whole body is across that line.
Unfortunately for Jake, he doesn't get to see that blue line. Only you do at home.
Illegal forward pass. Offense, number 11. That penalty includes a loss of down by Rude. The half is over.
Jake looks up at the giant halo video boards to make sure he was over the line, and he'll trot into the locker room, trailing by two touchdowns, courtesy of Joe Burrow and company. 17-3. Number two leading number four at halftime. Jamie's with Kirby Smart.
Coach, you have injuries piling up and your quarterback is hobbled. Where do you find the spark offensively?
Well, we got to get some guys in the open space. Got to find a way to get some of those guys the ball. You know, Dom's down, Kieris is down. Got a couple other guys banged up. But these kids are fighters. They'll come out and fight.
Thanks, Coach.
Yep.
17 points in the half. They haven't given up more than 20 all year long for an entire game, and that was their only loss to South Carolina. End of the half, LSU 17, Georgia 3. We'll be back with the Dr. Pepper tuition giveaway after this message from your local station. Burrow, plenty of time. Now he's going to go deep. Caught! Jamar Chase for the touchdown. There's the lob. There's a wide open Terrace Marshall. Touchdown, LSU. Back in Atlanta for the SEC Championship on CBS, presented by Dr. Pepper. Nightfall here in Atlanta, and the season might fall for Georgia as they trail 17-3. We welcome you back, everybody. Brad Nessler, Gary Danielson. Georgia's been playing football for about 125 years. They have lived by the run, Gary, and they got 21 yards in the first half.
Yeah, and it's not like LSU has any many running yards except for Joe Burrow,
right.
But they don't need it as much as Georgia does in this game. Also, Georgia, no big plays. They had some opportunities. They either didn't catch it or missed some throws.
Well, they're going to get a guy back that maybe can get him a big play. We'll have to wait and see. George Pickens, the freshman wide receiver who's the number two choice other than Lawrence Cager for Jake Fromm all season long, is back in after being suspended for the first half due to the fighting and the penalty and being ejected in the Georgia Tech game.
I'll tell you this. If Georgia gets back into the football game, go back to those last three plays that finished the half the way they defended LSU. Kept them in the game.
LSU gets the ball to start the third quarter. The kick hit the end zone, and LSU will come out to the 25. Here's what Gary was talking about.
Yeah, that Joe Burrow had him down there. They just got a first down. No timeouts left. But look at this. First throw is there, defended by DJ Daniel right to the outside. Then over the middle, defended perfectly. No space to throw. And then the true freshman does the job. And Kobe Dean, three great individual plays by this Georgia defense.
And on the opening kickoff that is basically just a touchback, I think it's Walter Grant the outside linebacker down on the special teams. You don't see an injury very often when the ball is sailing out of the back of the end zone and there's no return on.
Yeah, going down though, you know, you don't know it's going to be returned, but you see if we can find him here. Oh God, boy. It's almost a blind shot to tell
sure
you
was.
The truth. You have to be within 10 and 2 o'clock. And I think it was Tony Carter, 44, that got the hit on him. And it really was from the side. And I wonder if this will be reviewed as a helmet-to-helmet hit, if there's a closer picture of it. Remember, you cannot block guys blindside blocks anymore. And he totally got one. He never saw it.
Walter Grant, a junior out of Cairo, Georgia, a starter most of his time here for the Bulldogs. They've got him sitting up so far. Walter Grant heading to the locker room on that opening kickoff of the third quarter, as you're going to get another look at Torrey Carter coming down.
Yeah, first look at it from this side, and you see Grant sees it at the last second.
But if you take a closer look, is this not targeting? I think that's where
that's
they're
what
looking
at. Review. It's being reviewed.
It was targeting on the play. Personal foul targeting.
Yep.
Team number 44. The penalty is half the distance. The ball will be placed at the 12 and a half. Number 44 qualified.
Gene Steratore is our rules official along with us. Gene, I think pretty obvious, wasn't it?
Yeah, pretty self-explanatory. The things we look for is the lowering of that helmet, initiating with the crown, and that indicator that he does definitely lower that helmet to initiate contact. That's a target. And, you know, I would say, too, on touchback kickoffs, not that officials slow down or get relaxed, but you do have a tendency to slow down a little, maybe not be as focused. And a play like that coming out of nowhere, it's a good ruling by replay.
So Torrey Carter, who's actually a Georgia native from Valdosta's, day is done. Ejected from the game.
He has not played on offensive snap, but he is important on special teams.
Burrow, quick throw out to Moss. And Moss got it out near the 20.
That's been a quiet Thaddeus Moss in this game. I thought with the success that Cole Kmet from Notre Dame and Kyle Pitts had at that tight end position, we might see a little bit more of Moss, but very quiet in this football game, number 81.
Only a couple catches for 12 yards. Got six there, second down and four. Edwards-Helaire.
Yeah, that's good defense. That's good defense.
Only a yard as we check in with Jamie.
Ed Orgeron called Georgia a dangerous team, which is why he felt like they needed to execute offensively on this first drive. How about this? He made sure every LSU player ran out of the tunnel to start the second half because he told me he did not think they had enough bounce in their step in the locker room.
Burrow on third down, completes it. First down throw out to Justin Jefferson.
Well, Devon Wilson gets her a half step late, but this ball was going to that player all the way. Nobody else was eligible, and that was going to Justin Jefferson. Very similar to the other third down conversion, only this time Georgia had 11 guys on the field.
So in a perfect scenario after that penalty, Georgia hoping to keep LSU pinned back and maybe get a three and out. They don't. First down for the Tigers. Edwards-Helaire. Tough two. First half trends in the game. Well, this guy's been trending upward all year long. Joe Burrow, also the leading rusher in the game, by the way. Jake Fromm, 50% of his passes so far. And his first interception since South Carolina. DeAndre Swift was really a non-factor. And
I think it's Tyreek Stevenson, number seven, right out on the field right there.
And he's been a big-time player for him in the second half of this season.
Yeah, another one of the true freshman recruits that, as Ness just mentioned, he's gotten better and better. Very physical football player. Right side of your screen, you see it. And see the slipping again. The players are slipping on this turf.
We have not seen the cart until right now, and that's terrible news for Tyreek Stevenson, the freshman from Miami. Hurt on that last play. We've already seen Dominique Blaylock one of the big offensive weapons for Georgia, go down and came out of the locker room on crutches with a brace on his left knee. Jake Fromm was injured earlier, retaped his ankle and came back. So a lot of walking wounded and not so much walking.
And
I really
didn't even notice until the report that Jamie had that Curious Jackson, when Kirby was talking to Jamie, that Curious Jackson's also out on that and hasn't played much. So, boy, it has been quite a day for Georgia. And these, I looked again like it was slip and he hyperextended his knee there.
Obviously in a lot of pain.
Yep. Man.
And that pretty much tells the whole story, that Georgia fans obviously concerned for one of their up and coming stars on defense. Meanwhile, when action resumes, LSU has a second down and 8. And it's on 25. And there's Dominique Blaylock, as you see, with a brace on his left knee.
Sitting next to Lawrence Cager at the same time.
Yeah.
Surgery on the ankle.
Like a MASH unit over
there. Yes, in practice he hurt that ankle.
Back to the action. Early third quarter. Second down and 8. For the Tigers, who lead by 2 touchdowns. Edwards Elair comes out as a wide out to the bottom.
And number 16, Lewisine, goes right with him. That's been the matchup all game. Kirby said, you'll see, and we've seen who it is.
Georgia hasn't trailed by this much all year. Joe Burrow just calmly looking for more. Maybe not so calm now, trying to run away, and again he does. And uses the legs to get a first down. The leading rusher in the game is the quarterback for the Tigers.
Well, I'll tell you, leading rusher in the game, and you said it right, and he's been their rushing attack. Gets pressure, but he's going to run away from Wyatt. No way he can get there, and he gets to the corner, and that's been the game. This Georgia defensive rush, defense against the running game, has still worked. It's been number 9.
This time he throws to his safety valve. Edwards Elair, first guy missed. Monty Rice trying to stay with him, and number 22 drags him out close to another first down.
Well, remember, this is the same checkoff earlier in the game where he slipped and almost fumbled the ball in. The checkdowns to the outside for the Georgia fan. I don't think there's a better, as good as anybody in the SEC is the tackling for the two safeties for Georgia. They just tackle things in space, and that time, Edwards Alaire was able to elude the defender.
Kirby Smart told us, we don't see a lot of third downs on the cutups. They go, coach, how come? He said, you don't get in third down very often. Second and short. That's what makes third down pretty easy, because you get first downs like this. So Edwards Elair on the ground picks up the first down. The notable transfer quarterbacks this year. How about Jalen Hurts in overtime wins for Oklahoma after coming from Alabama. And Justin Fields, who was in Athens, backing up Jake Fromm. And Joe Burrow from Ohio State a couple years ago.
And if the score holds here, three of them will have their team in the playoffs.
How about that?
Might even be three potential Heisman finalists in New York.
First down just on the Georgia side of the 50. Play fake by Burrow. Going to go back to Edwards Elair, who was wide open in the flat. He's got another first down. He's going to take J.R. Reed out of bounds with him, and J.R. is still holding on without his hat. And
the decision making for Joe Burrow is amazing. The play is designed to go to Terrace Marshall, number 6. He makes the bootleg. He's trying to get the wheel route, but it is covered. So he turns around and makes the throw to the opposite. He saves plays. And there it is. It was actually Edwards Alaire that threw the helmet off. It's lucky he got away with it.
And then they had to separate everybody. The coaches for Georgia got in.
And that was a good job by J.R. Reed, not overreacting and get one of those, the second guy penalties, right? We've seen that so often. Just line up and play defense. Great job by J.R. Reed right there.
Most of that 71 yards rushing for LSU is their quarterback. Another first down at the Georgia 34.
52 of the 71 yards by the quarterback.
Burrow throws Justin Jefferson puts a move on, puts two moves on, and spins out for nine more.
Well, that name in LSU football, brother Jordan, Ricky, the defensive back, and now Justin. He has great hands. He's such a tough matchup. He's so quick when he gets the ball.
We talk so much about Jamar Chase, but he's actually their leading receiver as far as number of catches. And remember, let's get an update with Jamie.
Couple of updates injury-wise. Tyreek Stevenson did not look good on that cart, guys. He had to be carried into the locker room screaming in pain, but the team is telling me it's cramps for him.
Well, that's better news than it could have been. Another first down run for Edward Zelaire.
It is, and that's this LSU offense controlling the clock, controlling the board. Ball, 11 plays, taking time off the clock. It's going to approach over a five-minute drive here. Pressure back on this Georgia defense to get a stop.
Burrow loads and fires, got it complete. Marshall to the 10. Walter Grant back in, Jamie?
No, he is out for the game with a concussion.
Okay, thank you.
Where do you stop him?
I don't know.
Is it Chase or Jefferson or Marshall? All three of them. What an offense this LSU team has.
I'd watch out for number 9 to run this thing. First and goal at the 10.
Yeah, they tried that earlier and got stopped. I'd keep throwing. It seems like it's pretty good, the throwing game here.
Edward Zelaire now trots back in. Lines up in tight on the slot. Burrow throws behind his intended receiver. It's intercepted. No. Dropped.
And a flag down. It might be pass interference on the play. I think it's Eric Stokes got there just a little bit early on the slant pass right here inside on the tight end. Good matchup, but kind of plays through Moss on the play.
And he wouldn't have had to have done that because I don't think he was going to catch that ball. It's too far behind him.
Well, that's a tough matchup throwing to your tight end against a corner.
Pass interference. Defense, number 20. The ball will be placed at the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
Yeah, I think it was number 27. He just missed the number. Again, you're just trying to throw it to a big body here and force number 27 Stokes to go through.
So it's first and goal.
And now can they hold them to a field goal here? Remember, they held LSU last year to 5 field goals, 4 of them inside the 20-yard line. Can they do it again?
At the 3-yard line.
Georgia needs a stand here.
Burrow lofts it too far. Incomplete intended for Justin Jefferson.
This powerful LSU offense. You look out there on defense, you're trying to beat Dan Lanning, call plays as Ed Orgeron cheers him on. Which one of the 5 guys is going to get the ball, right? I mean, you have no idea every snap is going to get it, or as you said a second ago, Ness, could be the quarterback just keeping it.
Now they've got 2,000-yard receivers, a 1,000-yard rusher, and a 4,000-yard passer. It's never happened before. And it's second down and goal. 14th play of the drive upcoming. Georgia trying to bring some heat on Burrow, and they finally got to him.
Yep, the stand. A huge stand by this Georgia team. And look how fast Georgia substitutes. They get their substituted defense out there in an instant. Inside, boy. Jordan Davis at that.
Yeah, he can collapse a pocket
a
little bit.
Can he?
6'6", 330-pounder, and he is a star in the making, just a sophomore.
The discipline of Georgia switching their substituted defense, knowing that it could be fast.
First sack of the day of Joe Burrow. And Burrow all by his lonesome now on third and goal from the 10.
They got the tight end on wide on one side and the running back wide on the top. The receivers are inside.
Burrow flushed a little bit to the right again. Throws on the run and low and incomplete. Intended for Edward Zelaire.
I'll tell you, the last 2 stops by this Georgia defense at the end of the half and right here has kept it a ball game.
So that'll bring out the field goal unit. And that means Cade York again. York has hit one but missed one from 48 late in the second quarter.
You could tell by the play calls, Georgia defense, rush defense, that LSU does not believe they can run the ball. You could tell by every call they made.
28-yard field goal attempt by Cade York, the freshman. And this one's up and good. So tack on three more, but Georgia got at least the stop they needed to stay within 17, if that sounds good. He's Ben Stadium, and LSU has padded their lead 20-3. A 77-yard drive in 16 plays. Yep. They used the entirety of what is this third quarter so far and got a 28-yard field goal from Cade York. And now their kickoff man, Avery Atkins, has got it teed up. And he'll sail this one out of the back of the end zone, and Georgia will have to go to work at the 25-yard line again as we take a look at the GMC game changer.
Well, after last week, the LSU defense only gave up one touchdown in a 50-7 win over Texas A&M, and they're starting to make plays again in this game. Rashard Lawrence, Grant Delpit, and of course the future superstar Derek Stingley Jr. on the interception. The defense only 7 points last week and still only giving up 3 points in this game. As much as the offense has been doing well, look at what the defense is pitching.
Future superstar, look who's the tough grader now. He's got five interceptions on the year.
We're even.
First down, DeAndre Swift trying to get outside. Finally does a little bit. Picked up about 12 before he tiptoes out of bounds.
Well, the question was, could DeAndre Swift and the running game help out Jake Fromm? That's a good start.
One play in for Swift, and right back out and Harrion in.
And number one's on the field, George Pickens.
Yep. Lined up on the right side. Again, he missed the first half after being ejected from the Georgia Tech game last week. Had to sit out the first half of this one. See if he's going to be a factor here in the third quarter. Jake Fromm in trouble. Jake's going to run, and Jake's going to get the first down. So back-to-back runs, one by Swift, one by the quarterback.
And even if you have a sprained ankle, if you can make those 8, 10, 12-yard runs when it's wide open, when you have man-to-man coverage behind you, and you can make them pay for that man coverage because nobody's watching when they're covering their guys.
Jake got 14 on the scramble into LSU territory. Back to the air, and he tried to get it to Pickens, and Pickens couldn't hold on.
And that's communication. That's the communication that Jake has been struggling with all year. So in sync. Now listen, one more step and the slip by Pickens. See him slip again? We've seen that throughout the game. Perfect throw, could have been complete, but you know, when you're not in sync, and George Pickens, that little slip cost him the completion.
James Cook checks into the Georgia backfield. On second and 10 at the 48. That is Pickens in motion. Late blitz coming from, got rid of it, got it to Cook out in the flat. James Cook, I think he's got the first down. They needed him and DeAndre Swift to be receivers out of the backfield because of the shortage of wideouts.
Yep, I tell you that the confidence that Kirby Smart has in Jake Fromm, he exudes it when you talk to him, and let's see if Jake can pay it off for the coach.
Fromm throws out the flat here, and Pickens is looking for a flag from Christian Fulton, doesn't get it. So number one guarding number one.
The bottom of the play, Fulton, number one. Boy, it's getting physical out there. Remember, Kirby said, let's see if we can get our hands on him. LSU's doing the same thing, getting their hands on the Georgia receivers. I had my eyes to the other matchup, Simmons against Stingley. Look, more of the same. Look at that. The defenders and the receivers are understand they can be physical in this game. They're letting them play on the wideouts.
Second down at the 37 of LSU. From throws the out, got it complete out to Matt Landers.
No, it came out right at the end, I think. Stingley's on coverage. He had it, but watch Stingley get his hands on. Landers had a shot, couldn't come up with
it. You got to make that catch. You got to help the quarterback.
Absolutely. I think he didn't get Stingley's hand on it. That's just a drop ball.
Third down at 10. Not the kind of third down Georgia was hoping for on this drive that started off pretty briskly on a run by Swift and one by Fromm. And now they face third and long. Harrion trying to get wide. Not going to be able to. Chaseon got out there and forced it, and then only about a 2-yard pickup.
Let's see if Georgia goes fast. It would be about a 54-yard field goal from here on fourth down. Do they go for it?
Offense is out there.
Remember last time when they missed from long distance, it cost them a short field. What will they decide now?
They're 2 out of 6 on fourth down conversions this year.
I think the score has something to do with it here. 17-point game.
Absolutely. Warner, the tight end in there. That's Robertson in motion with Pickens out to that side. Fourth and 8 for Jake Fromm. Needs to make a play. Fires, completes it to Pickens. Pickens inside the 20, and he's got a first down. Georgia finally in the red zone.
Well, it started out with great pass protection. Allowed Pickens to work inside and make the play against Cardale Flott, number 25.
Now Georgia goes with some tempo here at the 17-yard line. Fromm waiting too long. They got him by the ankle.
Isaiah Wilson had the block, but not enough of the block. And Kalavon Chasen, number 18, is able to dive out and grab the ankle. Right here's the matchup to the bottom.
Nice spin move.
Oh, and he crawls for the sack at the end of the play. What great effort.
Kalavon in on his fifth sack of the year with that one, and it forces Georgia into being behind the chains again. Second down and 17.
Look at this formation. Double, triple stack. Ale is going to be Wildcat.
James Cook and Zamir White, but it's going to be Cook. I thought he was going to flip it to Fromm, but he didn't. Takes it himself to the 20. Inside the 20 to the 19.
I wonder if we're going to see that later, because it surely did seem like he was in a position to do that. Fromm comes behind. It was like, is he going to get it? No. Three LSU defenders played safe on the play, though, and stayed with Fromm.
So now third down and 12. Just inside the LSU 20.
And do you call plays thinking about four down territory here, or do you think one good shot and make it a 14-point game? It'd have to be really close for me. Otherwise, I'm kicking the field goal.
Blitz coming. Fromm throws up in the air. Again, Landers can't hold it.
Contested very strongly. Stingley and then Delpit comes over later. Two great players. Landers is open, gets inside. Perfect throw. Oh, great job by Derek Stingley.
Sure was.
Come on, that's hard. It's hard to play man-to-man all over the field. Don't know where he's going, and he was right there on the play.
So Rodrigo Blankenship, who's 1 for 2 today, will try a 37-yarder here. The one thing Georgia didn't want to do today is settle for field goals. They need all of them to get. They just missed one there.
Oof. That one was missed very similar to the South Carolina miss in overtime that cost him.
Guy that's been so good for so long and the leading scorer in Georgia history, and he's having a tough day here. 37-yard field goal to try to make it 2 touchdowns, but not to be. And Jake Fromm thought he had a touchdown throw and didn't, and the score remains the same. A year ago against Georgia, doing it with his legs. He had 66 yards and a couple of touchdowns last year. He has almost outrushed the Georgia team today with 45 yards on the ground on 9 carries. So it doesn't matter if it's throwing the ball or running with it. And in this case, we show you the athleticism of number 9. He's been special again. There you go. There's the rushing yardage.
Yeah, and last year, even though he rushed for those yards, he really had 89 yards of rushing in the game, but he had sacks for 23. So Fromm's on that bench saying, hang in there, hang in there. Still a game.
So in the entirety of the South Carolina double overtime loss, which they gave the Gamecocks 20 points in their only loss of the season, LSU's got 20 right now. And we've still got almost 20 minutes left to play. Here comes a blitz on Burrow. They're giving chase, and he somehow escapes again. And now throws late on the run. Got it. Justin Jefferson. Jefferson. Going to run out of real estate, but it's first and goal for LSU.
Brad, I want to ask you a question. Can you have two Heisman moments in 1 year?
I think after 60 years ago when Billy Cannon won it, I think we just saw the next Tiger to win it in 2019. Look at this play.
He had the Heisman play against Alabama with the run, and this one is his second Heisman moment. He stole that play from Georgia.
71-yard pass play, and somehow Houdini, Joe Houdini in the backfield, got away from everybody and then throws a strike.
Trayvon Walker tried to tackle him twice on that play. What a magnificent play. And if he's had a Heisman moment before, this one beat it. I'll tell you that. Look at him. Everybody, well, man, you are the man, Joe. You, even his teammates. Justin Jefferson down right there. Look at that. He's even going to go on a phone. And Joe Brady's going, I know good, and that's good.
Bayou Joe Burrow, 71 yards to Justin Jefferson, who is still on the turf after that long, long run.
Well, half of it may be he's just tired.
That's what I thought, too. And LeCount finally brought him down, but not before. It's first and goal at the 9, and Jefferson's up and on his way to the locker room.
Think about that. That could have been a 10, 12-yard sack on that play, and it ends up being a huge play for Jefferson. 71-yard gain.
SEC quarterbacks to win the Heisman. Been some great ones. I think he's going to be next in line.
Yeah. He's done it from the first game against when he pulled off that miracle against Texas with that great throw, all the way to this game here in the championship.
9-yard line for LSU. A handoff inside to Davis Price, and he got back to the line of scrimmage. That's about it. So right now, Joe Burrow's at 330 yards through the air and 2 touchdowns, 45 yards on the ground.
Again, the difference here from a touchdown to a field goal.
Second down and goal.
Take all of the clock.
Burrow on a crossing route. Got Dillon. He's down to the 4. Derek Dillon.
A little bit behind that time. If it would have been right on him, I think Dillon could have turned up and possibly taken a shot for the goal line. But he had to adjust to the ball. Jefferson coming in. Dillon goes out.
Jefferson says, I'm okay. I got my win back. Third down and goal. With a Georgia offense that has struggled to score points, if this is ending
100%,
27-3, I think it's going to be tough.
They keep it to 20, still in a game.
Third down. Again, everyone has a look to the sideline. Joe Burrow refocuses and a whistle.
Coach Orgeron says, no, don't like the look.
Take a timeout. Third down and goal coming up after this LSU timeout.
Nationwide helps you invest for you.
Watch the play right here. Trayvon Walker gets him once. Nope. Gets a chance again. Nope. Kind of like Johnny Manziel-ish. And then gets a 71-yard gain.
And the watch party going on in Albany, Ohio. Joe's hometown. They're loving every minute of number 9's game. So at the 4-yard line, it's third down and goal.
Can they get one of these slots to the corner of the end zone? It's man-to-man coverage. You got a lot of space back here. Which one of these two guys can get to the corner of the end zone if I was calling a play?
An empty backfield, so if it's not a Joe Burrow run, a pass is coming. But we've seen that run many times before. Third down. Quick slant. There it is. Gary called it. Touchdown. Wow. Terrace Marshall.
Well, I thought they might go to the corner, but they got an easier throw. They went slot on the slant. Man-to-man coverage on those guys inside. The threat of the run forced Georgia to put one more guy in the box, and he knew he had one of his slots. And he executes it with a perfect throw. That was a good timeout. The coach O knew how important those extra 4 points here were in this part of the game, and he took a timeout to ensure they had the right play on.
So Terrace Marshall's got two today. Joe Burrow's got three. Extra point by Cade York. Up and good. Another drive that took less than 2 minutes, but covered most of the field. 71 of it was on this magical play by Joe Burrow, who hooked up with Justin Jefferson for 71 yards to get it down to the 10. And then on a 4-yard slant, Terrace Marshall, LSU, 27-3.
I'm a Verizon engineer, and I'm part of the team.
Bayou Joe Burrow, another touchdown. Fifth straight game with three or more touchdown passes and over 300 yards, 339. Yeah. To be exact right now. Pretty special player in a special season.
Again, he plays. His stats are incredible. He seems to play better than his stats.
Check in with Jamie.
SEC Championship weekend is busy for everybody. Coach Ogeron was at the coach's luncheon yesterday where he said a really important thing about Joe Burrow. He said he's the most important player to ever come to LSU. Considering all the success this school has had, the players that have come through to the NFL, that is such a striking statement.
Is it ever? And I don't disagree with it.
Me neither, and I'll tell you why. The whole program needed a lift, and they needed a quarterback to do it. And his toughness and what he brought, they for years, they couldn't catch up to Alabama. It took Joe Burrow to catch up.
Georgia came in leading the SEC at number two in the country, allowing only 10.4 points a game. And LSU has rung up 27, and we still have a lot of football left. From, and that is intercepted by Stingley.
His quickness is incredible. His hands are incredible. He baited that throw.
Second pick of the day for the freshman.
I'm going to say Brad's right again. He's not a future superstar. He's a superstar. A year ago, Coach Ogeron said, we've got a special player coming in. Look at him. He anticipates the throw. He looks back, and his hands fights off the receiver. Squatting on the play, gambling on the play like all the good corners do. They have such faith in themselves that they want to make that big play. They squat. They cut underneath. They don't worry about the tackle. They go for the pick six.
And that is his sixth pick of the year. At the 13-yard line.
And right now, LSU is playing for the number one seed.
And they're looking like it to me.
First of all, I don't see how you can keep it from happening.
I don't either, exactly.
Their resume is unbelievable. And I think this whole eyeball test has gone away. Everybody told us last night before the Utah game that the eyeball test said Utah was better. Let's just go with resumes. Nobody knows exactly who the best team is. This LSU team might not beat Ohio State, but they deserve the number one seed in my mind.
From the 9-yard line, they can get a first down at the 3.
Gotta finish it. Gotta finish it.
Burrow is sending everybody. They still can't get to him. He'll get a yard before he goes out of bounds. That Stingley interception is second of the game, and you saw his hands. You played with his granddaddy.
I did.
And
I think I had a part of this because I see so many bad passes to him. And he had to make those great catches, and it definitely was inherited down the line.
And Ed Ogeron told us flat out, he's a two-way player starting next year. I promised his dad I'd leave him on defense for one season.
That'll make him a potential Heisman player.
Of course it will. Third down at 5.
Again, bump and run right here. Nobody back there to help. All over the field. They're selling out.
Burrow, the fade to the corner to Jefferson. Touchdown, LSU.
Man-to-man coverage all over the field. Pick your side, pick your matchup, and you got it. Coming right out this way. Watch this. A little bit of pick inside. Actually, beautifully done. Did not run into everybody. Don't let the referee make a call. Just kind of create a little traffic, and the Georgia player bumps into his own player.
So Jefferson in the end zone again for the 14th time this year. And it all started courtesy of number 24 with the turnover. Cade York for the point after. Up and good. And with 45 seconds remaining in the third quarter, number 2 LSU and number 9 Joe Burrow, as his mom Robin looks on, running away with the SEC championship game 34-3. Stingley with a pick, his second of the day. A tough day for Jake Fromm. Another special day for Joe Burrow and his talented group of receivers. 34-3. 3 LSU making a statement against the number 4 team in the country. And again, Georgia will start at the 25-yard line on the kickoff by Atkins as we take a look at the Chick-fil-A college football playoff rankings. And Ohio State's got a date with Wisconsin. LSU is on their way to their 13th win. Clemson's got Virginia. Georgia trying to hang in there, and they got a long way to come back.
And here's my argument. I don't know if LSU is better than Ohio State, or Ohio State's better than Clemson, or Clemson's better than LSU. But this resume that LSU has put together this year, to me, and I don't think anybody in the committee knows either for sure who the better team is. Their top 10 wins and the way they're playing this year, to me, I don't see how they cannot have the number one seed.
Second time they've started a 12-0 season in school history, and they're 15 minutes away from number 13.
And LSU has put the Georgia fans leave early. There's a lot of empty seats here already from the Georgia fans.
Well, they were about 70-30, and now they're all dressed, disguised as red seats here at Mercedes-Benz Stadium, where the Falcons will play tomorrow. There'll be a lot of empty seats for that one, too, against the Carolina Panthers.
And as good as this is, look at this. Everybody said, come on, Georgia, you cannot expect your defense to hold up. And the lack of scoring punch, eventually, it just caved in.
Fromm throws over everybody's head.
Flag
down on Jacoby Stevens.
Yep. Right now, this Georgia team fighting just to fight, basically. Just fight and have pride. In this type of the game, you look around at your teammates and go, I'm not going to be the one. When we watch the tape, it looks like I'm not all in right now.
Mm-hmm.
And holding defense from 24, 10-yard penalty, automatic first down.
And if you're LSU, you have to just hang and keep the intensity and finish this game off. The number one seed's important.
They call that a holding call on Stingley, not pass interference on Stevens. So just to correct that.
Yep.
Might be the final snap of the third quarter upcoming. Big Fromm pressure from the backside. He's hit by Palelon Chase out, and the ball is out, but it's going to be an incomplete pass.
Chase on lines up on the left side sometimes, on the right side other times. This time he's to the top of the screen. Before we saw him coming from Fromm's right side, this time he comes from the left side, and what a play. That time he beat Andrew Thomas.
Who's an All-American left tackle. Chase on has a sack today and almost had. He does have the two sacks now.
The muscle, the strength, what I thought might be a part of the game, Georgia could never establish a running game.
James Cook on the final play of the third quarter.
They could never out-muscle this LSU defense.
Tyler Shelvin and Rashad Lawrence make the stop. A couple of those big heavies on the defensive line. And the four fingers are up for LSU. They know they're 15 minutes away from an SEC championship. 34-3 at the end of three. We'll return to Atlanta right after this message and a word from your local station. We'll be right back. It's been all LSU in the SEC championship game here at Mercedes-Benz Stadium. Commanding lead, the fourth quarter just about to start, 34-3. And Georgia faces a third down and long to open up quarter number four. 418 yards, more than twice as much, couple extra minutes.
That Georgia offense has finally caught up with them, hasn't it? I mean, they finally fought a quarterback that could stress their defense, and their lack of plays on offense has finally caught up with this team.
From on third down and long, a long day, and a pass is complete to Robertson, but short of the first down. This has been a dominating performance by LSU. I mean, they've been that way every time we've seen them this year, but we really thought maybe Georgia's defense could hold them.
And I think the lesson for modern college football is you got to have an offense.
Yeah.
No matter how good your defense is, if you can't score with the RPOs and the pick plays and everything that they do nowadays with the tempo, just having a strong defense is not enough. You need offensive firepower.
And they have got it, and Georgia has it today. And they have to go for it on fourth down here, even though it's just a few seconds into the fourth quarter. Need to basically get to midfield. They get it out to Herring, and I think he got it. That's, see, Patrick Queen took him out of bounds and took half the Georgia staff with him.
Yep, that little swing pass, same pass that LSU was running to Jefferson, get it to Herring, and gets it the first play. Look at Coach. You know what I'd be telling my team right now if I was Coach O? No targeting, no fighting.
Yeah.
You'll lose the first half of the playoff game.
Here's a toss to Herring. He had to bounce off his own would-be blocker and Wolf. Man, got something out of that. Got three or four.
If somebody gets into a fight with you, walk away and be careful with your leading with your helmet. We cannot afford to lose a player in the first half of our playoff game.
Just watching Logan and Rashad Lawrence and those guys on that defensive line, man, they are still going 100 miles an hour. Here's a slant to Pickens. And Pickens brought down by Phillips, but he's got it down inside the LSU 30. They could have used him in the first half.
Yeah, it was a selfish play by him doing that in the Georgia Tech game with this championship coming up. Hurt his team. Badly hurt his team. They needed him.
Apologized to the team early this week. Jake Fromm told us. First down. Fromm throws too high and too wide, intended for Pickens. And Jake's picking himself, well, his linemen are picking him up. Amazon Music brings you today's scholar athletes, Charlie Werner, the tight end for Georgia, and Kalevon Chasen, who's got two sacks today for LSU. Amazon Music showing their commitment to the investment of our future by donating $1,000 to Georgia and LSU's general scholarship fund. That's Brandon Fatoko's dad, the defensive lineman.
He's easy to spot.
He doesn't
need a number.
He does that Polynesian war dance usually a couple times a weekend, whatever city he's in.
It's working.
It's working. Second and 10. Fromm throws wide side in and out of the hands of Demetrius Robertson. Kerry Vincent was covering back there. It's third down and long again.
They actually play three safeties on the field. Kerry Vincent's kind of a hybrid. He's the closest to a cover safety they have. He's on the slot, does a great job right there. Really tough pitch and catch on the play. And again, the referees, the officials, all game, they've been consistent. They've been allowing everybody to get their hands on the player.
Apu Ika, the true freshman nose tackle who came in when Tyler Shelvin was shaken up a little bit earlier, himself down right now.
Two pure beef patties, three slices of...
Now it's time for our ExxonMobil game recap. SEC championship game, Mercedes-Benz Stadium. And it's been a dog day afternoon for Georgia. Dominique Blaylock out for the game early. Jake Fromm was out as well, retaped his ankle, came back in, but he's had a struggling day against the likes of Derek Stingley and company, who's got two interceptions. And then Joe Burrow has done what Joe Burrow has done all season long, and that is light up opposing defenses to the tune of 393 yards and four touchdowns. He's the leading passer in the game. He's the leading rusher in the game. He's the leader of the game for LSU, and they're partying already in the stands, and they will be in the streets of Atlanta.
He's even has a reception in the game.
That's
too,
right. He's done it all. We welcome you wherever you've been today to join us here in Atlanta. Brad Nessler, Gary Danielson, Jamie Urdahl, Gene Steratore. And you can't say it's a shocking situation because that's the way LSU has played all season long. But boy, if you're a Georgia Bulldog fan, you look like that.
Just wonder that first pass of the game. Georgia needed the lead so bad in this game to play from in front. That first big potential play and the drop. Just wonder, could it have been a different type of a path for the Georgia football team?
When LSU's playing with the lead, they just keep attacking. From on third and 10. Bringing an extra rusher. From down the middle, incomplete, intended for Pickens. And it's fourth down again. This is what Gary was talking about. The first snap, you wondered if Georgia were going to do what Georgia does is run, run, run. Nope. Jake Fromm ripped this one, and Tyler Simmons should have had it. And that's just one of a couple just on that opening series that could have made a difference, or at least could have earlier. Another fourth down, fourth and 10. Fromm, back shoulder throw, what a catch by Pickens. And that just shows you some of the talent this kid has.
Skill. It was actually offsides on LSU, so he had a free play on it, and Pickens again shows you his potential, why he was a five-star.
Offside. Defense, number 18. That penalty is declined. The result of the play, first down.
And could a guy like this have made, there's the offside, the difference. It was Caleb on chase.
Well, he wouldn't have hurt him, that's for sure. Look at the skills he has.
Got it out to Robertson, ran out of territory over there around the 5-yard line. Bring up second down, and Georgia threatening to score a touchdown for the first time today. They were in the red zone one other time, and then a penalty backed them up. They went for a field goal and missed it. So this is their best opportunity to get a touchdown. And it's taken a long time here to get set up. Still plenty of time on the play clock. They looked a little confused. Now I guess Jake Fromm's got him where he wants him. Second down at 2. They can get a first down at the 3. Here comes everybody after Fromm. It's going to pay off, or isn't it? He got away and he throws late, incomplete, but he did avoid a sack, and now there's a flag in the end zone.
Well, I'll tell you, if without a pass rush, George Pickens had an easy touchdown. They crossed the inside receivers, and Pickens goes on touch, wide open across the play.
And Jake,
oh, it's a pick.
Pass interference.
Sure. Yes.
Defense, number 7.
Wow.
The foul occurred in the end zone. By rule, the ball will be placed at the 2-yard line.
So it was Grant.
Automatic Delpit. First down.
And Grant Delpit on Eli Wolf, the tight end.
What a collision right there. Pickens wide open, but the pass rush, and Delpit gets the foul.
So first and goal at the 2. Georgia in search of its first touchdown of the day. Brian Herring with Fromm, high snap. Fromm throws quickly and completes it to Pickens for the touchdown. So they finally get a wide receiver in the end zone. It's their freshman from 2 yards out.
Well, let's see if he learns a great lesson from this thing, the whole thing, and he's a great player next year, because you can see the skill he has. Look at that catch.
A little over 4 minutes on the drive. Rodrigo Blankenship in for the point after. He's hit 197 straight extra points. He struggled as a field goal kicker a little bit today. And this one's up and good. So Georgia goes 75 yards in 13 plays. A little over 4 minutes. And Jake Fromm can still smile, at least. That's his 22nd touchdown pass of the year. You look in on the lights of the city, our aerial coverage sponsored by State Farm. I still have not been on that Ferris wheel.
No.
My wife won't go with me.
Good move.
I don't want to go by myself.
LSU and Coach Ogeron goes with their onside kick hands teams. They want to show Kirby that if you're going to try to sneak a possession here, you're going to do it against our hands team. We're not just going to line up on our regular kickoff return.
And here they go with the hurry up, and it's a knuckleball It goes out of bounds, and that's the worst kind of kickoff.
That's as good as LSU could get. It didn't even get a chance for an onside kick, and LSU gets the ball in great field position.
Let's check in with Jamie.
Well, Heisman winners come out of the woodwork when you're at the SEC Championship. Kind of unusual to see Marcus Allen, though, at this game of USC. He connected with Ed Orgeron when he was coaching at Southern Cal, but they stayed connected, and Marcus actually spoke with the team, LSU, last week. He said, guys, good coaches make you do tough things to become the great players that you are. Look at my coach, John Robinson, when I was at USC. Ed Orgeron has now hired him. He still calls him every week to check in and ask him for life advice. Pretty cool connection between those three guys.
John's a good one to ask advice for, I'll tell you that much.
I'd listen to that speech, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I would. First down for Joe Burrow and Clyde Edwards-Helaire, and Helaire breaking tackles. Monty Rice brought him down, but he got 9 yards. LA's newest superior court judge wants to fix a broken system, but what happens when the system pushes back? It's a new All Rise Monday at 9, 8 Central on CBS.
Well, final score matters, and LSU finished this thing off. They're going to win the game, but they want to win it with a big win.
34-10 right now, 11 minutes to go. Edwards-Helaire, look at the spin move.
That's his move.
Yeah, and he picks up first down with it.
He scored that big touchdown against Alabama with that same move. Took the handoff and spun out of a tackle just like that.
Never gets old watching that.
Nope.
No slipping there, just spinning and sliding and a first down.
And using the clock now, running the ball, taking that play clock down under 8, 7, 5 seconds.
And it's Burrow on a late pitch with an option look this time. Edwards-Helaire, and he's still got it. So now it's somebody other than the quarterback who's going to be the leading rusher maybe when it's over.
So here's how this option is. The option is, how long do I wait before I pitch it? Because I'm not running it right here. That's the option. Do I keep it a little bit? Pitch it.
Clyde Edwards-Helaire with a 20-yard game just became the game's leading rusher over his quarterback with that one. And we're under 10 minutes. And back in Georgia territory at the 34-yard line. Edwards-Helaire, and again positive yardage. Looked like he was going to get stopped, and he got almost 5. Jamie was talking about John Robinson and Marcus Allen back in the day. There's the look from USC, and there they are now. Marcus doesn't look a lot different.
No, he doesn't. I was going to say the same. Looks like he could suit up and play.
And John, Robbie's going, Nestler, you're supposed to say the same thing about me.
your old partner.
Yeah, we did a couple games together. Second down and 5. Davis Price. Got a couple more. And let's get another update. Let's just go over to the end zone to my guy, Adam Zucker.
Yeah, Memphis is going to the end zone. It's a day for Tigers. 7 lead changes ending with Brady White to Antonio Gibson with about a minute to go as they hold off Cincinnati to win the American, looking to get to the Cotton Bowl as the highest-ranked Group of 5 conference champ, all while Tigers coach Mike Norvell appears to be headed to Florida State. See if they can edge out Boise and App State, guys.
Well, it might be the last time he holds that kind of trophy up, huh? It goes maybe to the ACC. That's the word anyway. Good coach, good team. Burrow thought about running and went down courtesy of Devontae Wyatt.
He wasn't going to take a chance and throw a pass that could potentially be picked. Nothing there, no quarterback draw, and eats it. Oh my God, they're going to go field goal here?
Yes, they are. Cade York, try a 50-yarder.
Wow.
Now his long this year is 52. Trying to make it 37-10 here. Kick out of the way. Got in there somehow.
Ed O knows what he's doing.
Cade York, who went 5 for 5 against Texas A&M last week and just went 50 yards on that one to add to the LSU lead. Well, everything seems to be working. Cade York, a freshman, says yes, sir. 37-10. Before we're done later in the game, the play of the game presented by Jersey Mike's Subs. I'm pretty sure that's going to be an LSU play. There are a lot of them. Lot
I
of
know which
ones.
One it's going to be.
I think I do too. We don't want to give it away yet. Avery Atkins to kick. And as been the case most of the day, a touchback. Although this is a line drive. And Harriet's going to let it go anyway. So the matchup of offense and defense that we talked about at the beginning of the game.
Yeah, look at the passing concepts here. One player's going up, crossing underneath. These are the NFL concepts brought to this packet. Joe Brady said, I'm going to bring it. Joe Burrow said, I'm going to run it, and we're going to score points. This Georgia defense has only given up 20 all year. That was to South Carolina in one game, and that was overtime. Joe Brady's offense, I don't know what he makes as a coach this year. He's going to make a lot more next year.
That's right. As Orgeron has said, there's been a plan in place to keep him in his place at the LSU offensive staff. And he said it's been that way for a couple weeks or a couple months. And in the Georgia defense of Kirby Smart and Dan Lanning and coming in, giving up 10 points a game, and today 37.
I'll tell you, at that time, James Cook was wide open for a touchdown. This LSU defense continues to play what they play. They play bump and run to the outside. And if you can execute, you have a chance to get some yardage. Now Stingley backs off. Fulton backs off. Playing off just a bit.
Second down and 10 for Fromm and company. Inside handoff to Cook. And Cook, positive run. College football playoff sites. The Peach Bowl right here in this building in Atlanta, one semifinal. Fiesta, the other one.
And look where it ends up.
Yeah, in New Orleans, their backyard. They've done pretty good with that, haven't they? Jake Fromm having one of those tough days, but there's a good delivery to Robertson.
I think you got even Jake Fromm, 5, 6, 7 seconds, and Robinson comes clear across the field to catch that one. As you look at those games that they have played in the dome. I did one of those games. I did this Oklahoma game right there.
Fromm up first down. Going to go deep. And Pickens trying to catch it. Couldn't quite hold it. Tried about three times to find the handle.
That's what I mean. LSU plays what LSU plays. That's their defense. Again, physical play all day. They've allowed the defensive backs to hand check and jostle. And both teams have gotten the feel for the game.
And Fulton's a little shaken up after that, getting entangled with Pickens at the end of the play.
All of the coaches around the league now have told us when any of their players feel any kind of a twinge, they want them to stay on the field. We'll come out and get you. You know, Nick Saban said, I hate to see my guys do that because it makes it look like they're beating on us. But the new way to do it is get up. If you don't feel perfect, if you're winded, take a knee.
And they're working on his right lower leg. Christian, a senior out of Metairie, Louisiana. They got a lot of homegrown talent, man.
He's another one of those projected players to be high, could be a first round draft pick at corner.
And Cordell Flott will come in to take his spot in the secondary. So LSU all season long heard about how their defense wasn't top notch, how they weren't a complete team. The last 3 weeks, they've kind of shut everybody up, I think. They're playing pretty good defense now. Dave Aranda is the leader of that group, the defensive coordinator.
Seems like once they got healthy, they got better.
Yep.
And they've gotten better inside, too. I'm really impressed with, you know, they have not lost the line of scrimmage. Ed Orgeron told us, we can't lose inside, and they have not. It hasn't been a lot of stalemates. It always hasn't been perfect, but the Georgia offensive line has not dominated in this game.
They're all in the average of 6'5", 329, but today it hasn't mattered. Because Georgia's done very little on the ground. Second down and 10, they have to pass now, obviously. And Jake Fromm going deep. Simmons, the intended receiver, and Stingley was back there in coverage.
It's tough to keep your intensity up when you're on defense in this game. You look up at the scoreboard, know you're going to win the game. On offense, you're just trying to get it respectable. And on defense, when you don't have that intensity, it just doesn't work as well.
Right. So it's been the story all day for Georgia. Third down and long, it seems like. And another one here.
Yeah, and LSU is 8 for 14 on third down. Georgia, 3 for 12. Big difference in this game.
And they're still blitzing front. And down he goes to paid off. Patrick Queen with a sack.
He was originally blocked pretty well on this play, but he just kept going. His intensity comes right from the middle. Watch him right there. Gets blocked pretty good. Trey Hill gets him, keeps going, gets him again, and then spins back to make the sack.
Georgia's been good on fourth down today. They got another one. This is fourth and 15. And Camardo will punt. End over end kick. And out of bounds around the 11 or 12, I think. Put it right at the 12-yard line. With 5:45 remaining in the ball game, Kirby Smart knows that his team's chances of the playoff are falling apart here at Mercedes-Benz Stadium. Well, another special day for number 9, Joe Burrow. Some things are going well, and they have gone well all season long. Four more touchdown passes today to go to 48 on the year. And he's going to lead his team to the SEC championship, yeah. Something that you'll always have to remember a great season by, and then much more yet to come.
Remember, he got sacked on the last play of the last drive before the field goal. He better be handing the ball off. He cannot get hit again in this game. As mom and dad said,
the kiss cam wasn't even on him.
Yep, and I think that's a Heisman kiss right there. Imagine this story. A three-star guy who had to beg his way almost to get a scholarship to Ohio State, his dream place. Nebraska and Ohio State is where he wanted to go, and he has to transfer to LSU, and he's going to win a Heisman.
And he keeps it on the ground. And as Gary said, his dad Jimmy coached at Nebraska. Both his brothers played there, Dan and Jamie. And they're quite a bit older than Joe. And so he's the baby of the family. Yeah. So the whole family calls him Joey. I don't know what you want to call him, but he is no ordinary Joe. I'll say that much.
Right. I mean, who wouldn't want to do this with the boy playing like that?
Where are we going to put the trophy, honey?
That's awesome.
That is. Been a special run.
How about what he said
family.
After his junior year? Dad's coaching at Ohio University, and he said, my only offer was Ohio University. He said it was like a pity offer.
Yeah.
You know, he said, I needed something better than that.
Throw out to Justin Jefferson. And he got taken out by Campbell and Reed.
Yeah, I'm listen, that was an RPO, and he chose to throw that ball. I'd be like going, oh my, we just saw a disaster happen before. I'm just surprised he's just not handing the ball off.
Third down and one. Again, using as much clock as possible before the snap. Davis Price in the backfield with him. Thaddeus Moss, the tight end, standing there as well.
I think he's going to take a timeout. Ed Ogeron standing right next to the official.
And that probably will be Joe Burrow's day. There's the timeout. And now number 9's going to walk over, and the fans that are still remaining are his fans. You can bet your bottom dollar on that.
You think Coach O is telling Joe, on these plays, I don't want any more passes. When there are RPOs, go with the R-O part of it. Forget the P.
If he doesn't come out, or if he does come out, I should say, Miles Brennan would take the field at quarterback, but I don't see him out there right now, so. That was his first pass this quarter, at least, that last one. And
he dropped back and got hit and sacked the last time he was in there.
Third down and one. Georgia shifting on their defensive front. And again, we're going to use as much of the play clock, although there's no time coming off the game clock. Davis Price switches sides and will get the carry at the first down. Out to the 25.
Let's see if we get a curtain call here for the quarterback while he's out there. We could trot off that. Here comes the curtain call.
There it comes. Yep. What a season. What a game.
What a man.
Boy. He's been fun to be around. So is the whole family, actually. It's been a kind of a great ride for the whole family. His mom, his dad, his brothers, his girlfriend Olivia, the whole group. So Miles Brennan in at quarterback here in the final 3.5 minutes. On the ground, Chris Curry. And Curry getting a little action here late in the game. Well, LSU came in to the college football standings number 2 behind Ohio State. If 37-10 over number 4 isn't good enough, I don't know what is for them to move back to number 1.
I know. And it's important. Now, the number 1 seed has never won the championship from that spot. But this year, considering the power of Ohio State and Clemson and LSU, not to play the other two. Now, I'm not saying anything bad against, let's say it's Oklahoma. But, you know, I mean, if you're choosing who to play.
Yeah, exactly.
So the one seed, I think, is an important decision.
Clemson, of course, the defending national champion, haven't lost him for, I don't know, ever, whatever their winning streak is, 27 or something. I don't think anybody really wants to play them, but you got to go through everybody if you're going to win a championship anyway.
I mean, listen, for our old friend Barry Alvarez, he's probably yelling at us, saying, hey, what if we beat Ohio State here?
I know.
So for our old friend, we'll say, well, they'll have to talk about it,
yes,
right?
Yes, exactly.
Wisconsin versus Oklahoma.
Down near 2 minutes. Miles Brennan to take the snap. Chris Carey to carry the ball. And out across the 40-yard line. Don't forget, coming up after our game, Adam, Rick, and BJ will have scores and highlights on the college football postgame show presented by Rocket Mortgage from Mercedes-Benz Stadium in Atlanta. Number 2 and number 4 got together today, and number 2 in resounding fashion about to win it.
I'll tell you, that play of the game, when it was still a ball game, when they had him sacked twice, when Burrow makes that 71-yard.
You trying to give away the play of the game?
No, I don't know if it is or not. but that was the ball game right there. That was when the game ended for Georgia. A sack there, still a game.
Down under a minute to go. Georgia's not going to stop anything here, even with the timeouts.
Yeah, Kirby even punted on fourth down there with the score. And right now, really, you know, LSU, if they wanted to, could just take a knee.
Georgia's going to fall to 3-5 in SEC championship games. And they'll fall to 1-3 against LSU in those contests.
LSU's got a better team, right?
They do.
Top to bottom, better team.
And LSU is going to go to 5-1 in SEC conference championship games as Miles Brennan will do the honors with the victory kneel. And that will do it. West over East, and LSU is 13-0, Geron. How about that? 13-0. Coach O. Heck of a performance to win the SEC champions. The Tigers of LSU here in 2019. And the Heisman Trophy will go to that man, I predict. And it won't even be close. Derek Stingley, a couple interceptions. Joe Burrow, a hug with Jake Fromm. 4 touchdown passes for Joe on the day. 48 on the year. And the streamers are purple and gold. Much to the chagrin of the red and black Georgia backers. And there's two guys with a lot of respect for each other. And one had the kind of day to remember and one didn't. And Grant Delpit back and healthy and happy. And the LSU defense does its job as well today. Well, Gary kind of gave it away.
Is that right?
It's time for the play of the game presented by Jersey Mike Sub. You get a free sub, my friend. Here it was, an opportunity twice maybe for Trayvon Walker to get to Joe Burrow. He somehow gets away. Not only that, keeps his eyes upfield and throws downfield to Justin Jefferson. And Jefferson almost took it the rest of the way. And here's how Chris Blair called it on the Tiger Radio Network.
Calls for it again, now gets it. Late pressure comes, Burrow spins away, now runs back to his right, looking downfield and throwing on the run, has a man open, Justin Jefferson at about the 43-yard line, far side, cuts back across the middle of the field, foot race inside the 20, 15 and 10, brought down around the 9-yard line.
And there it was, another magical moment. And as Gary said, can you have two Heisman moments in one season? We've witnessed both of them. Let's go down to Jamie.
Coach Brad Nessler just said it best, 14 and Ogeron. How does this season feel to you from a big picture?
Just so proud of our football team, our coaching staff. Again, so happy for the state of Louisiana and LSU. But we said tonight, this is not our final destination. Wherever they tell us to play, whoever tells us to play next, we're going to be ready.
Well, along the way, there may be a New Orleans trip, Coach, so we'll see you when we have the trophy presentation. Joe, you just had a little exchange with Coach about who would want the game ball. Why did you want to give it to your head coach after a game like this?
No, he deserves it. He's done so much for this state and so much for this university. I love that guy. If you don't want to fight for him, something's wrong with you.
You just went through your SEC season. You got a couple weeks off before you play again, but before that, you have a Heisman Trophy presentation. Do you feel like you put a campaign together to bring that trophy home?
You know, that's for other people to decide. You know, we put the film out. We're 13-0. That's all that matters to me.
We still have to give you a trophy. We'll see you on stage.
Thank you.
Now here's what Jamie's talking about. The game ball goes to the coach. Goes to Burrow and then right back to the coach with his wife Kelly behind him saying, we got a spot for that somewhere in the house.
It was his vision and he believed it when a lot of people didn't believe in him, and he got his team to believe.
Well, Joe's already won one award, the Johnny Unitas Golden Arm, as you saw on that banner over there on the sideline. There's more trophies to come for Joe Burrow, trust me. 37-10, SEC champions for 2019, the Tigers of LSU from Baton Rouge. For Gary Danielson and Jamie Erdahl, I'm Brad Nessler saying so long. Final score 37-10. College football postgame show presented by Rocket Mortgage. Coming up next after these messages.
CBS Sports College Football Postgame Show is presented by Rocket Mortgage.
Would it be a contest or a coronation? It was the latter. LSU 37, Georgia 10. The Tigers are SEC champions for the first time since 2011, and now a celebration. Tonight on CBS begins with Bowl, followed by back-to-back editions of 48 Hours. Tonight only CBS, as we welcome you to the College Football Postgame Show presented by Rocket Mortgage. I'm Adam Zucker, joined once again by my buddies Rick Neuheisel and Brian Jones, who were very correct about the Tigers winning behind the Heisman frontrunner Joe Burrow.
You know, there's so many online dating services, right? Oh. Relationship services. I've got one. InstantOffense.com. Joe, meet Joe. Joe Brady and Joe Burrow have combined for a season unlike anything I've ever seen. They are on stage again today, and they did not disappoint.
So swipe left for L and LSU?
Exactly. I'm telling you.
That is incredible. I tell you what, Joe Burrow had multiple Heisman moments in this ball game, but what I also know is they can play small ball when they need to. They can pick and poke with the best of them, so it's not always the long ball, which they also hit when they need to, but this is a complete football team.
It is a strong case for number one, and they're getting set for a trophy presentation. We'll have that for you live from Atlanta when we return.
Yeah.
Welcome back to the College Football Postgame Show presented by Rocket Mortgage. Hugs and tears of joy among those in purple and yellow as we send it down to Jamie Erdahl for the trophy presentation.
Save the last one, we're going to be on here.
Good evening, Atlanta. We are here to congratulate and award the 2019 SEC Championship to Louisiana State Universities. To no one's surprise and to everyone in Louisiana's pride, Joe Burrow is your MVP of this game.
Congratulations. That's yours. Well done, man.
Joe, I know you just put together a season that everybody dreams of. But now that you've lived it, do you feel like you fulfilled a dream that you had all along?
Absolutely. This playing for this great university in this great state is a dream come true for me. I have great people around me, great fan base. I couldn't be in a better place.
You had a couple impressive runs, passes. You even caught one of your own passes and were able to run for one. How can you put into words the season that you just had in your second year at LSU?
You know, this is what we worked for. This doesn't come to a surprise to anybody on this stage right here. You know, we've worked for this for our whole lives. 13-0, you don't get any better, but we're not done yet.
I saw you take a moment and take this scene in. What message do you have for all these people out here that were with you along the way?
Thank you so much for allowing me to become a Louisiana native. I love everybody in the state. The state's been great to me, and these great people have welcomed me like a brother.
Well, congratulations once again. Next up, Heisman Trophy ceremony for you. Coach O, you've been through a lot in your career. Are you able to summarize the feelings you have right now about this team and this season?
Just so proud of these guys, but this is not our final destination. We have two more games to play, so we're going to get to work tomorrow and get ready to go on our next opponent. But we are so proud to win the SEC in the best conference in the United States. I'm so proud of our coaching staff and our players and the greatest fans in the world.
I know we talk a lot about Joe Burrow, but there are some gentlemen on this team that deserve to be recognized as well. Clyde Edwards-Helaire, Derek Stingley Jr. What is there to say about the remaining players on this group and the product they put on the field for you?
The heart, the courage, the character, the grit. I see these guys on a daily basis, how much they're committed to winning, and they're great representation of the LSU Tigers. I'm so proud of these guys.
Well, the only thing we have left to do is award a 2019 SEC Champion Trophy, and I will allow the commissioner of the SEC, Greg Sankey, to do so.
Thank you, Jamie. Let me say thank you to the fans of the SEC, the greatest fans in college football. Thank you, too, to the fans from the University of Georgia tonight, to a great team for a great season. Congratulations to them on their Eastern Division Championship. Now it's my privilege to present to Coach Ed Orgeron and the LSU Fighting Tigers, the 2019 SEC Championship Trophy. Congratulations.
That's it for us here in Atlanta. Your 2019 SEC champions have hoisted their trophy. This stage is rocking. Have a good evening, everybody.
And the celebration continues for these LSU fans. None of them left, and they might be right back here on December 28th, whether they're number one or number two, right? But they made a strong case for number one, and we'll see what Joe Burrow's old teammates do tonight in the Big Ten Championship as Ohio State faces Wisconsin. Mr. and Mrs. Burrow sharing a smooch.
What a dream they've lived.
How about that?
We made a pretty good baby.
We're talking now about who's going to be number one. It's a foregone conclusion that Oklahoma will be the fourth team in this conversation.
Right.
But who will be number one? I think LSU has stamped their ticket to be the number one team, Brian, given this performance and the impressive nature of it.
I would agree with you. They played the number four team in the nation. They whipped them. It was never in question. And so this was as impressive as it gets in a conference championship game. We'll see what happens later. But I thought LSU should have stayed at number one when they were, you know, demoted a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, they went back and forth. Now, for Georgia, Where do the Dogs go from here to be the team that can win this?
Well, we've been talking about him all year. This offense has been kind of stale. So he may, Kirby Smart may have to make like his former mentor and boss, Nick Saban, and sexy this thing up somewhat. They had Justin Fields, of course, so maybe they were looking towards the future. They need to go back and revisit that.
One school of thought is it was attrition. They just caught up to him at season's end. The other school of thought is he's got to catch up. We saw an unbelievable rise of an offense there in the Bayou. Does Kirby Smart have to follow suit? Justin Fields out the door. He's got to find another one, see if they can catch up with these Tigers.
Justin Fields, by the way, 37 touchdowns, one interception. He got some Heisman talk, but Joe Burrow is the front runner. Who does he meet there next weekend?
Jalen, go ahead.
I'm going with Burrow. I also like Hurts. And how about Ja'Marr Chase leading the nation in receiving 20 or 18 touchdowns after the day and 20 yards per catch?
Justin Fields, Jalen Hurts, and Joe Burrow will be the three finalists in New York. Joe Burrow will hold up that straight arm trophy because he said straight arm to anybody who said he couldn't do it. He was a phenomenal performer all season long.
Yeah, some teams have a couple contenders. Well, we thank you for watching the College Football Postgame Show presented by Rocket Mortgage. Here's a look at what's coming up tonight on CBS. And a reminder, next Saturday, be sure to join us for an American tradition, the 120th Army-Navy game presented by USAA. The game is at 3 Eastern. Our coverage begins at 2:30 Eastern from the sideline. And the NFL on CBS kicks off tomorrow with a doubleheader. Most will see the Ravens and Bills, followed by the Chiefs and Patriots. It all gets started at noon Eastern with the NFL today. For all of us, have a great evening and congratulations to the LSU Tigers.